logged into Twitch. As promised, everybody, we've had a change in plans with this week's broadcast. We have a change in plans with our guests. Well, one of them particularly, and the other one swapped out. But joining us this week for a special and unlikely duo is the pair of Eggman and Sonic. It is Dr. Mike Pollock and Roger the Craig Smith, everybody.
That sounds about right.
That sounds about right, yeah. Roger the Craig.
Yeah.
It's unlike the Smokey Frontier the Bear, which is not his name.
It's the Sonic Frontier stream with our very special guest stars, Roger Craig Smith and Mike.
Wow. Goodness.
Yes. I mean, you know, it also could have been Ezio Auditore and Meat from Ultimate Muscle.
Hello, everyone. Hello, OG Modern Sonic. Hello, Cryptor the Crusader. Hello, Dodger 24848. And Alam Ortiz. What's up, guys?
So Alam Ortiz's second time in this kind of broadcast, as a matter of fact. First time was during the Forces project, which Paul debuted with us for, technically, two years back. Oh, hey, that's Bloody Boy. Hey, Blood, how you doing?
Blood! OG Modern Sonic says, what's poppin'? Hey, Mike, hey, Roger.
Once again, a very special welcome to Don Quixote Homing and Batman.
Yes, they are taking questions, OG Modern Sonic.
Just bear in mind, everybody, that I know that this is a fairly big duo we have tonight, so if we can't get to everyone's questions, please forgive us. It's just we got a lot going on tonight.
Hello, Amanda Ristine. What's up?
And it sounds like Mike and Roger suddenly decide to disconnect and probably go have a battle in the background.
I guess?
No, it's your show. We're letting you guys lead the way here.
I get to play as Roger for the first time ever. I get to play as Roger.
Feel free, though, to join in on the conversation if you must. But even then, as Gray put it earlier. Hello, WCJ94. Welcome back.
As a matter of fact, why don't we get things started off with some streamer-based questions. So I might as well start off by asking this to both Mike and Roger, and this is something I've asked everybody so far. If you weren't doing voice acting, what would your ideal career choice be?
Oh, boy. Mike, would it be male model for shiny shirts or what?
Yeah, there's that. That would be the side gig. I'd be back on the radio. I was on the radio for a while, and if radio hadn't gone to crap town, I would still be doing it.
Oh, I feel you on that one, Mike.
Mm-hmm.
No Budget Media, welcome.
I gotta say, one of the things I like to ask everybody is, how did you make your break in the industry?
Oh gosh, well it sounds like Mike, radio, I'm assuming. Mm-hmm. How did you get into radio, Mike?
As a kid, I loved theater and I loved radio. I did community theater and school theater, and it came time to pick a career. Radio seemed a little more stable than acting, not so much. And so I was in radio from the middle of college up through 2008. Fired a couple of times along the way because that's what happens in radio. And by the time I realized I'd been fired for the last time, I was able to fall back on the theatrical career and was able to take my radio resume and make a character demo out of it, and people seemed to like it.
Nice.
So how about you, Roger? What made your break in the industry? How did you make your break?
You know, it's funny. I like Mike, I was into theater as a kid. I was doing goofball stuff, like, as, you know, mimicry and impressions and everything that, you know, when you're young and you don't know how the world works. And honestly, I guess my foray officially was into starting down the path of stand-up comedy, working as a comic for about 5 years, and then kind of going to college at the same time. Not just only 5 years, but more like a 7-year collegiate path. And then eventually the people in the industry kept asking me more and more about the voices and characters I was doing in the business, and so I started thinking,
we got a $50 donation from Layton Lover 65.
Hey, Very Bloody, cool. Layton Lover, thanks so much for the $50 to Alzheimer's Association.
And I also say the comments on the Filmify page, so I will say this about Leighton Lover 65. I appreciate you guys' contribution to this amazing cause with such amazing guests.
Yes, it's great to have my college roommate here watching this series, so thanks so much, Blood, for joining us. But, yeah, going back on what we were asking, Roger, didn't you get your bachelor's at Chapman?
I did, yes. Got a bachelor's in screenwriting. Well, film, with an emphasis in screenwriting.
Oh, really?
And from Chapman University back, or was the George and Christina Dodge School of Film and Media, or whatever it all is now. It's like 19 different titles, but back then it was just Chapman University.
Huh.
Dodge College, I think, back then.
You know what's funny? Or I'll let Nigel finish his statement.
Yes, thank you. I have a BFA in creative writing.
Oh, very cool.
Yeah, so, but I mean, like, only thing I've done with it, though, is just find a job, basically, right now, so.
Can I ask?
Yeah.
I'm having difficulty hearing you guys mixed in with the gameplay audio. Is there a way that we can adjust that?
Yeah, I can always turn off the game audio if you'd prefer.
Or just turn it down a bit so I can hear you guys.
Yeah, see, that's, yeah, let's go to the in-game settings. I think I can fix that.
That's what's so annoying about some games is that they're just too loud.
Well,
it's much louder than
as long as you
recorded.
Just take down all the sound effects, music, and all that stuff, but leave the voices up, I'm fine with it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, let's see.
Most important part when you think about it.
Yeah, let's take this down to 11. Maybe a bit quiet, but if it turns out to be an issue even after this audio adjustment, by the way, we got a donation.
Another donation!
Amanda
Ristine for $20. Thank you.
Thank
Amanda,
you so
way to
much.
Go.
Yeah, thanks. So if this still turns out to be an issue with the audio, I might just have to turn the audio off, unfortunately, because on Discord,
no,
it's easy.
You clearly.
Yeah.
This is better.
Yes, mm-hmm. Very good to know, sir.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Ristine says, thank you, Roger and Mike, for helping raise money for such a great cause.
You know, it's the least I could do to sit here in front of a microphone at the end of the day and hang out with you guys. I'm working so hard on doing this, so.
Well, you've worked hard for so many years entertaining us with,
Yeah, you guys are the ones that put all this together, though, and it's like we get to kind of show up, and if it's a help, that's great, but I'm doing very, very, very little. But for the folks who've donated and for the folks who've supported, that's the real work, so thank you guys.
Yes. It's nice to have you guys along. You've entertained us for so many years, so you guys take the joyride. We'll navigate the ship for you guys this time.
Hi, Lars.
Hey, Lars. Thanks for being one of our two illustrators for the series, by the way.
Yes. Thank you. It's
nice
Lars.
Nice job
the
on the work.
That...
Yeah. The Prince Lars.
Yes.
It's Lars and I were the people that handled the perma art for serving the Selfless. It was the least that we could do.
Round of applause.
Round of applause, guys. In the chat.
Bravo.
Golf clap.
Oh, thank you so much. Oh, it's an absolute honor.
But I was meaning to say, Roger, I almost called you Roger like Tara once did. Hey, Tara, by the way. One thing I was meaning... Yeah, there you go. Hey, there's the hater. Hey, Roger! Hey, Roger!
I must say that I appeared at a convention with both of them, and I was very saddened that there was no live Hey Tara action, as it were.
Oh.
I'm trying to think of what city was that?
That was Sacramento.
Yeah, she was walking around scaring the crap out of everybody, as I recall. So the Hey Tara was sort of like sidestepped for her, like sneaking up behind people and startling them. So I thought she was going to do a compilation video of that because she got me, she got Charles Martinet, she's covering all the bases. She's an evil, evil person who's out to destroy us all.
Destroy us like. All. I would talk like Richard Horvitz, but
also,
I can't.
That's a great point, Amanda Ristine, if I could jump in for a minute on her comment. She started playing Frontiers a couple months ago after not playing Sonic since Sonic 2 when it first came out. Man, have things changed.
Absolutely.
Oh my gosh, yeah.
Yes.
I was meaning to say, Roger, speaking of Chapman, Chapman was actually one of the universities I was considering applying to 10 years ago when I was starting college, but I ended up going to Laverne instead.
Oh, Laverne! Okay.
Oh, you know where my first college is.
Well, I mean, you know, No, but I know where Shirley is.
Oh, there you go. Everyone makes that joke when I told that was the only neighborhood I lived in.
Go hang and fruit.
Shirley, you jest.
I guess the movie Airplane had an influence on you.
Yes.
It had an influence on me? True.
I'm not joking, and stop calling me Shirley.
Yes. OG Modern Sonic is asking Roger, I recently finished an anime on behalf of my sister recommendation called Zega Pain. Remember that show?
Oh, yeah.
Zega
Pain. Nice.
That's going back way old school.
So basically when you were first starting out?
Pretty much.
Wow.
Yeah, gotta be like one of my very, 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 very first gigs.
Along with the Pizza Hut commercials.
Oh, yes.
Zega Pain
probably goes
address.
Back way earlier than that.
Got another donation.
Man, they're coming in tonight.
And who's this donation from?
$10 from Rachel
Wade.
Thank you very much, Rachel Wade.
Thank
even if it's
you
only
so
a penny, everybody out there, even if it's only a penny, everything helps the Alzheimer's Association. So thank you so much.
Hello, Decoya.
And don't
dude.
Worry, we pinned the Tilify page on the top in case you want to donate.
Yeah, and if you can't find it in the pinned messages for whatever reason, if you scroll underneath my video feed, there's a widget where you can link your donation to Tilify.
Oh yeah, one of the things that Colleen talked to us about last week was your involvement in Gudetama. So,
yes,
it was crazy to find out that it was once again the Sonic and Tails pairing, where
yeah.
you and her were cast as, I think she was the chick and you were Gudetama.
Exactly, I'm the little egg with a butt crack, and she's the little hatched little chicken.
Yes.
Does that have
that
any?
Not intentional. I didn't know. I mean, I you know when got the offer and accepted and started working, and all of a sudden. I remember thinking, like, oh, man, this adorable little voice out of this little chick character. What, who's voicing the chick? And they're like, oh, that's Colleen. I was like, what? And then I thought, oh, how funny. Sonic and Tails, at it again. Look at that.
Well, speaking of cute, I was meaning to say, one particular book I remember my kindergarten and first grade teachers, I should say, reading to me when I was in grade school in New Jersey was Laura Numeroff's If You Give a Blank series. So when I found out that, I mean, when you first posted that video where if you give a voice actor a book, I thought that was just you making up a voice. But then when I found out that you were actually not just Mouse but Moose, I said, oh my god, you revitalized my childhood.
Oh boy. Now I feel old.
Yeah. Yes. I was going to say, if you give a voice actor a broadcast, he might just join us to help us raise awareness for Alzheimer's Association.
That's quite possible.
Yeah.
I feel like... Roger, I feel like you're really good at animal voices. I mean, as much as I would love to see this happen, I know full well it's not going to happen, but having a Calvin and Hobbes series would have been awesome. And if I was a voice acting casting director, you would have been my first call for that.
Oh my gosh, but Calvin or Hobbes?
Hobbes.
And another donation.
Another donation!
Thank you! We hit $400!
Woo!
And another one!
We got another one!
Everybody, thanks for helping out.
Started my Starbucks bill, but you know...
Yay!
Hey-o! $10, thank you. My grandfather suffers from Alzheimer's, so I hope the money from this fundraiser goes to good use. And to Mike and Roger, keep doing what you're doing.
Hey-o!
Very kind sentiment, sir. Thank
yes.
you.
Thank you. And Alam Ortiz donated $5.
Thank you, Alam. And nice to see you for a second time fundraiser that we're doing with the Sonic cast and crew. It's very nice to see you again.
Yes. Thank you so much.
So, Mike, I know that we asked you this during Sonic Forces, but I figured since this is a new stream, it's been 2 years later. One of the fascinating facts is that you are the longest running voice for Dr. Eggman. Actually, Roger, you're the longest running voice for Sonic. So...
We're making history, guys. We're making history.
Yeah.
Mike's the one who's laying all the groundwork, though.
I guess that's a fair statement. I mean, it's been 20 years since he was cast as Eggman.
It will be in 2 months.
They had video games back then?
They did.
Yeah, can you believe it?
They're all black and white. And it was.
They're all about having two lines and a dot.
Yes.
Hello, Seb Shampuru.
Hey there,
so
thanks
I guess
for joining.
The question, So the question that I have that I think I asked 2 years back. So how did you get approached to do the voice? Was an auditioning process? Was there? I'm sure there was an auditioning process, but you know, comes to. I'm sorry. Go
being
ahead.
In the right place in the right time. I was already doing stuff for 4Kids TV and the Fox Box and all that stuff at 4Kids, and they had known me for my work in Ultimate Muscle and for Kirby Right Back At Ya. And as it happened, the production team for Kirby Right Back At Ya got assigned to handle the dubbing for Sonic X. And the director and producer was really keen to have me audition for Dr. Eggman. So, sure, yes, I will. They sent me clips of Dean Bristow to sit and mimic, and I took them home, and I'm Dean Bristow. Rah, 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 rah. Went in and did my audition, which was more or less just like that. And they, I guess the Sega folks, not so sure. They had me come back for a callback or two. And after 3 times around of going, I'm Dean Bristow, rah, 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 they decided, you'll do. And yep. then that premiered, sneak previewed August 23rd, 2003.
August 23rd, huh?
Hmm?
It's not too far out.
Nope.
Hello, McCreamy.
McCreamy, thanks for joining us. Oh, Roger, is it true? Well, it is true because it stayed on your Amazon profile, but being not just one, not two, not 200, but 170 different voices on regular show, how were you approached by J.G. Quintel to take part in that project and be the predominant or the most recurring voice actor?
Well, that was okay. That's, I mean, so rarely are you approached 9 times out of 10 by an actual creator of a series. That's pretty rare. I mean, it can happen, but honestly, like as Mike was saying, the overwhelming majority of stuff that we do is just based on showing up for auditions. Mm-hmm. And that's set up by casting associates, that's set up by networks that reach out to casting associates, and then those casting associates reach out to talent representation, and then the representation reaches out to the talent and says, hey, they got an audition, they want you to go in, and I think you'd be a good fit for this, so, you know, go give it a shot. And that's honestly what happened, is I got called in by Chris Zimmerman, our director on that series. And she wanted me to do some incidental work. And I think that was to kind of introduce certain actors that she works with frequently to the creative crew there. And came in and did, like, you know, Skater Punk A or Skater Punk B for some, you know, particular episode. And then they liked working with me and came in like a month later on another thing. And then they liked working with me and then came in like a couple weeks later on another thing. And then came in a couple weeks later, a couple weeks later, a couple weeks later. Pretty soon they were like, well, we like this guy for versatility and that kind of thing, and next thing I know, they offered the role of Thomas to me, and suddenly it wasn't even offered. They were just like, hey, we got this role, we're gonna have you play this character Thomas. So it's always sort of like planting seeds. You just go in, you hope you try to be as vocally malleable as possible, and you throw a bunch of stuff against the wall and hope that it sticks with the ears of the folks in charge, and if they like working with you, they bring you back. And that's honestly how that happened. And so the joke of, like, you know, all those different characters on regular show that I always make is, yes, there's a lot of different characters, but a lot of them are what we call incidental characters. And so it's not as if, you know, some 178 completely distinctive original, you know, voices were utilized, because you very likely would wind up with a couple different, maybe just a couple different characters that might sound kind of similar to one another. But just working on a regular show, just such a really, really fun crew of everybody on there. And of course, JG is no exception, but the entire crew was just a really neat, swell group of human beings that were incredibly talented. Many of them have gone on to create other very successful, you know, original types of work. And it's neat to see, like, how many people have kind of gotten their start doing something on something like working at Cartoon Network, then getting to do something like a regular show and going from there. So I was lucky to be a part.
That's a very long-winded story, but it sounds like it was a remarkable journey.
It was.
Thank you. Hello,
did that answer the question?
I'd say so. Yes. I'm sure if I rewatch this video after we're done, I'm pretty sure it will have answered, and I'll say, that fits.
Yep.
So I would say...
Sorry, we have a question. I'm sorry to interrupt. We have a question in the chat. Roger, can you please say Baldy McNose hair in Sonic with an Italian accent?
After the Stone Age.
Baldi McNose hair in Italian.
Whoa!
Baldi McNose hair.
Sonic. Oh my goodness! $500?
Who made a $500 donation?
Baldi McNose hair.
Shiny purple shirt. God bless that shiny purple shirt.
Fight the return on investment.
Who made that donation? I'm still trying to figure that out. Not that it's a bad thing, it's a good thing because it helps the cause, but who did that?
Honestly, it doesn't matter where it's coming from. It doesn't matter where it's coming from. It's greatly appreciated.
I don't think my entire collection of shiny shirts costs $500. But thank you
so much, whoever did that.
Was insane.
I can't offer any of you guys I can't offer any of you guys enough of a thank you for how generous that was. Thank you.
What was the request of the line?
Can you say Baldi McNose hair in Sonic with an Italian accent, young Ezio's voice?
Baldi McNose hair in Sonic in Italian voice with Sonic.
What was the request? That's hang on.
This is the worst improv show ever.
Yes, it is.
I think it's only just Baldi McNose hair.
All right, hang on. I'm going to get into the chat.
I think it was only just Baldi McNose hair. Hello, Nightwolf 2462.
Hey, Nightwolf, I almost called you Baldi McNose hair. I'm sorry.
Okay, so one of the things I was gonna ask in addendum with Gray's question regarding how you got on with regular show Roger, how did you get on for Sonic? And I'm sure it's the same answer. It was through the audition process, like just do constant auditioning, callbacks, and whatnot.
Yeah. to ruin it, yeah, that's exactly what it was. Hang on, yeah. I'm finally in the chat on Twitch, so I can see. Like, can you please say Baldi McNose hair in Sonic? Yes, Baldi McNose hair in Sonic with an Italian accent, young Ezio's voice.
Yes,
that was genius. I like that.
That was great.
Thank you.
Also, hello, RC Ben AEP. Thank you. Thank you for joining us.
Yes, thank you everybody for being here. This is a momentous occasion all the way around. And everything goes to a good cause once again.
Yes.
I would like to add for the well-meaning people who say things like, you should be in that show, or you should audition for that show. It's not that easy.
Not.
It's a lot of invitation only. Sometimes there are open cattle calls, but not for the stuff you'd want to see.
No.
Yeah.
So, yeah, there's a lot of being in the right place at the right time, having the right connections. So, yes, I'd love to be in all sorts of things, but I can't just barge in and start recording. They tend to hate that.
We have another question for Roger from Seb Shampuru. Have you talked to any of the previous Sonic VAs?
Oh, gosh. I think I know we've chatted at some point, but, I mean, given, honestly... Given the dynamics that can exist within the Sonic fan base, I think a lot of us tend to keep that just sort of separate.
Yeah.
Understandably so.
I think there was another question about Harvey Street.
Oh, Harvey, yeah. Harvey, was it Harvey Girls Forever, Harvey Street Kids? Yeah, I'm seeing this in the chat. The question is for Roger, what was it like performing on Harvey Street? Harvey Street was a ton of fun. Oh, gosh, I'm trying to remember some of the voices. I think one of my favorite things to do on Harvey Street was the voice of... Was it a squirrel or a skunk?
It was Pink Eye. I think it was Pink Eye Bob the Elder or Skunk.
Pink Eye! No, I remember doing Pink Eye, but there was also like a squirrel or a skunk. Is that a squirrel or a squunk?
That'll be the next character.
A skunk get together. Let's create a new thing.
We have a question.
Yeah, doing a lot of fun voices on that show.
Great. Alon Mortiz has a question for Mike.
Yes?
What kind of music do you like most?
I'm not ashamed to say show tunes is choice number one.
Yay!
And then, let's see, show tunes, oldies, novelty, and country. Not necessarily in that order.
Okay.
You know, I'm
from Bubble. Oh, you're from Finland. Cool.
Cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha. If you're from Finland, I gotta admire that song.
Yes, we're big Eurovision fans, so...
Especially Carria. Gotta love Carria.
And they put a robot emoji.
Very nice to see that. Now, I just, I know I should be mainly on track with what we're raising money for, but I have a little bit of a request with Roger, or for Roger, I should say.
What do you got?
Do you think that you could say a Sonic line in Moose's voice? Any line at all.
The Permint Bubble is now following the platoon.
Hey, new follower, thank you.
The Permint Bubble is now following the platoon.
What was that?
Oh, no, Moose.
Oh.
Not Ezio, Moose.
Okay.
Yeah, and you're convincing Canadian voice.
The mysterious follow voice.
Yeah, AI is working really well.
Oh,
God,
a line is Moose in, but a Sonic like, whoa. Okay, gosh, I gotta remember, like,
oh, hello, okay, no copyright law in the universe.
McLean is now following the platoon.
Oh, the
hell? Hey, Peppermint Bubble, thanks for staying up so late.
Yes. Thank you, Angelina, for the $20 donation. I wish I could donate more, but here's a little something. No worries. It is absolutely no worries. Donate what you can.
Yes, thank you. McCreamy. Roger, I'm crying. I'm crying.
Here's what's funny. When people want me to say stuff in a Sonic voice now, this is what Mike and I have talked about, like, even at the conventions. Like, which version now? We ran into that even doing, like, the Twitter takeover. Is it's like, look at, I guess it's a nice problem to have. Having done something like this for so long, it's like now we've lived long enough, Mike, to have multiple versions of these characters that we're still getting to do. The Frontiers version of the characters is so drastically different than where we started.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
That was actually a question that I was going to bring up. So the process for Frontiers, from what my understanding is with the writers, the voice actors, actresses, is that it was a lot more cinematic. What was the approach for this? For this particular performance for Frontiers? Because it's just raw emotion. There's a lot more emotion, a lot more nuance in the deliveries and everything. And I'm just curious, what was that process like for Sonic Frontiers versus the other games?
Mike?
Oh, well, some might consider it unsettling. The direction we were given was just that. We're going for a little more grounded, a little more realistic. I was given a few minutes to process that, and I realized when I had done my original record and then went back to do some fixes months later, I listened back to the originals and I realized I wasn't even doing a character voice at that point. It sounds entirely like me. I'm a little unsettled. But yeah, that was the direction. We're going a little more real. So for something that can be so cartoony, what does that mean? And I guess this is what it meant.
It is kind of interesting to hear it. Every time they play reference for me, in my mind, I'm always up like here with it. And then all of a sudden they play me the reference for the file, and I'm like, oh man, I'm down here. It's much lower than I always sort of anticipate. And like Mike, I'm like, wow, it barely feels, I mean, there's still a performance that we're doing, but it barely feels like a quote unquote character voice, which is a good opportunity to remind people of the fact that it's like what we do is not necessarily rooted in just being a voice. It's like it's always about, I mean, the acting comes first for sure. Mm-hmm. And then from there we establish what, you know, aside from the voice, what we establish is character, along with everybody that we're working with, the director, the producers, the writers, anybody who's involved in the creative process.
And it ends up in some very surprising, unexpected places sometimes.
What's great is that people have actually responded to it, because it could have just as easily been kind of like, oh man, what are they doing now? You know, it's like, and I think people like the fact, I honestly, as you go through the gameplay, as you go through these scenarios and what was at stake, to have done maybe more like the Colors Sonic, would have taken the sort of gravity of everything, I think, down a notch. And, oh gosh, this goes back to
2010
Disney projects that somebody was saying, look, your good guy is only as good as your bad guy is bad, and vice versa.
Mm-hmm. I was also going to say, Roger, that when I heard your Sonic voice for this particular game for the first time, I was like, did Sonic turn 24 years old?
And here we go. How old is Sonic? And then the argument.
That's the last time I'll bring it up then.
Yeah, but I was going to say, I actually really like Roger's inflection of Sonic here in Frontiers because it's still deeper than what I'm used to hearing, but somehow it actually works pretty well, I got to say, especially given the new plot direction that Ian Flynn gave everything.
So we can't take credit for any of that stuff because it's not as if I've made a decision on this. That's very much Sega informing yes. Jack Fletcher, our director, as to what they would like done, and then all of us working together to achieve that.
And there's a whole room of people who sign off on what we do, and they don't let us leave until they get what they want. So what you hear, what ends up in the final product, a whole bunch of people said, yeah, that's good. That'll do.
We have a few more questions in the chat that I need to
address.
Go up.
Just before we get to that, just for a quick moment, want to say the pinball section in Sonic Frontiers, mwah, I love it. The music, this is probably one of the few moments I'm probably going to geek out in this entire stream, but this song, I don't know what it was, but when I first played this game and I got to the pinball level, the music took me back to the days of Fantasy Zone, back to the wonderful days of the 80s arcades. I was born in 93, but I feel like a lot of those classic Sega arcade games, I found out, and I no exaggeration, many few moments, I do not cry tears of happiness to find out that this was the original composer for Fantasy Zone. Fantasy Zone is probably one of my favorite Sega soundtracks. If we're at non-Sonic Sega soundtracks, because I'm a big Sonic fan. I need to iterate that right now.
So am I.
This song, it became my bloodstream. It's so beautiful. It's so tranquil and relaxing. I love it to bits. I'm sorry. Anytime I get to the pinball section of this, it's one of those things that I sincerely wish that at some point in one of the Frontiers updates, if someone over there is listening,
you know it's not going to happen. These guys can't affect the Aether Stall, and it's not going to happen.
I know, but it would be so cool if the challenges were replayable, because this pinball one is using so
You're having way too much fun with this, Stalin. I'm sorry. Yeah,
sorry, the music. Something about...
Anyway, back to the question.
Is, yes, let's get back to the chat questions for a while.
Yeah. Sorry.
We have plenty to go through right now.
Yeah, we should definitely let our viewers get in on this since they're helping us with the cause along with these two men.
Yes,
I need an egg, McCreamy.
Hey, there you go. Hey, Sonic. Hey, how are you?
Roger, do you remember Zaggy from Tales of Vesperia? Man, that was such a cool character.
Welcome to the Hornet's Nest!
Nice. For Mike and Roger, was there a dream part you auditioned for that you thought for sure you weren't going to get or were cast?
All of them!
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's always a surprise when someone likes what I do. Because there are so many auditions that don't go anywhere and you kind of get used to it. And then just this past couple weeks, I got two big dubbed things that you'll hear about one of these days as soon as I can share that. And I was delightfully shocked with both of them. Like, really? Oh, good. Because on the flip side, there's a big dub that was just releasing this week that I had to look back to see if I auditioned for. Didn't book it. And it was like, oh, okay. You win some, you lose some.
Without a doubt. That's the ditto to the answer. Like, we're working actors. We're constantly auditioning every single day. You're trying to submit something to someone somewhere to hopefully find out that in 6 months, 6 days, 6 hours, 6 weeks, 6 years, you might wind up working again. So the idea that there's a dream role or anything like that. It's like the goal is always just to nab the job, is to be good enough and competitive enough to be available enough, as they say.
Yes. Just living the dream.
Yeah, uh-huh. It's just that you want to book a job. That's what it is. So the dream is getting to call a day behind a voiceover microphone, a job.
And that's be awesome. Open-minded enough that even if it's not something fun and animated, it could be a boring corporate narration, but that's still a job you didn't have yesterday.
If you did a boring corporate video, how would you guys sound like?
Oh, that's not an if. That's a I have.
Oh, my gosh.
Oh, you have?
My first job.
Sure. It depends on the project, but it... Well, let's see. There was the one for Dupuytren's contracture, which is a thing where your finger gets stuck in a trigger finger position and your doctor has to come and give you a shot. Those are not the right words, but that was the condition and the remedy, and it sounded very serious.
Close enough.
Wait, for trigger finger?
Yeah.
Dupuytren's, I got one of those going on right now.
Oh, how'd you get a trigger finger, Roger?
A reed for one, or do you have the condition?
No, I literally have, like, my middle finger on my right hand has decided to develop into a trigger finger. It's, mm-hmm. like, fun.
That's because of all the photos you take.
Mike. Yeah, but don't invite me over to do the injection. I'm not qualified.
Okay.
You're not even a doctor, Eggman. You already lost your doctorate in Sonic Boom.
Yes.
I do have... Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Also, Seb Shampuru, Roger and Mike have... voice multiple characters in the Sonic franchise.
Yeah, but think about it. Oh, Dave, sorry.
Plug for the product. It's Xiaflex. X-I-A-F-L-E-X. Xiaflex.
Ask your doctor, Eggman, if Xiaflex is right for you.
Use only as directed.
Yeah.
See, these two can cooperate, everybody. They're not always nemesis.
Xiaflex is not for everyone. If you're allergic to do not take Xiaflex if you're allergic to Xiaflex.
That always cracks me up.
Don't let the social media team get wind of this. They'll write this into something.
It's hashtag whatever. But I always just crack up at those disclaimers that it's like, that it's always like, do not take this if you're allergic to it. And it's like, who out there, why did that have to make it into it? Like, what person sued a medical, establishment for, hey, I'm allergic to this and I took it? And I had an allergic reaction. And it's like literally saying, if you're already knowledgeable that you're allergic to something, do not take it. And yet, mm-hmm. that's just a hilarious thing. It's like, I don't know.
It's also kind of philosophical, too, when you think about it, because, who was the first human to eat food or drink water?
Adam?
I'll look at a cow's udder and say, I want to drink that.
Yeah.
I'm going to try some horse.
I'm gonna try some ants. I heard they taste like salt and vinegar chips. Wait, where are salt and vinegar chips? Hey, that's what we'll do for salt and vinegar chips. We'll make them taste like ants.
Oh, Kishimoto-san, Izuka-san, yes. We've run into those folks throughout lots of different productions throughout the years. To answer OG Modern Sonic's question.
I want to add something to that. I actually did meet Izuka-san in 2016 while waiting in line for Sonic. I think it was the Sonic 25th anniversary party,
and
I
think that was when you guys were
doing you guys were doing like the live reading for one of the episodes. I think it was that improv. I think it was improv for like Comedy Chimp Con. It was a Sonic Boom live reading.
Yeah, no, the live
that was at the 25th anniversary.
Yeah,
it was the 25th anniversary party.
That thing was wild, man. Crush 40 playing live.
You know, Nigel and I are going to be seeing Crush 40 in 2 weeks' time.
Very cool. Where are they playing at?
Too Many Games.
Oh, Too Many Games Expo?
Yeah, we already know you're going there, Roger, so we can't wait to see you then, too.
Oh, is that... that's Philadelphia, right?
Yes, yeah. It is, good sir.
You're kidding me? Crush 40 is going to be there?
On Saturday night at the Fun Center across the street, yes.
Oh, that's cool. I did not realize they're... Wait, but they're a part of Too Many Games, right?
They're part of the expo. They're in a separate place because the convention's gotten so big, but yes, they're still part of the expo.
That's cool. I haven't seen those guys since the 25th, so it's like, that'll be great. Yeah.
Oh my goodness.
Hey, maybe you'll bump into Nigel and me that actually know. We should probably let you have your space.
I'm honestly sad. That makes me all the more sadder I'm not able to go this year, because sadly,
Hey, stop complaining. You're going to the symphony in Los Angeles. I don't want to hear
going
it.
Going to the symphony? Okay. I'm going to the symphony because of the gratitude of a friend. I'm not going whatever because did, I have the money.
Stalin, can you can you read the comments for me? I have to go use the restroom.
Yes, that's fine. Where did you leave off on? There's a couple of them I think for me. Is it Sonic? Okay, check out some stuff. Decoy Dad 00 asks, wait a minute. I mean, the tech here outpaces Eggman. Could you please say, Roger, this is one for you. Could you please say, Moza, what?
Mozambique here. I don't want the whole chat to just start becoming everybody wanting to hear you say something in a Sonic voice or that kind of thing. So I'll tackle a couple things here. I'll take care of the check out the consoles request from earlier. And so I'll give you that version of the Mozambique here. And here it comes.
Mozambique.
Because that was also
check out the consoles. Check out the
consoles. What? Why default one? Oh my god.
Read my manifesto in the Sonic voice. There you go. That's a cry for help.
That's a cry for help in more ways than one.
But one of the things. One of the things I do gotta say is I know Roger, you have
got a donation.
Yay!
Donation $75
from Amanda. Woo-hoo!
Sorry. We had 1,000.
We broke 2 milestones in one night with this fundraiser. Can you believe that, everybody?
Thank you, Amanda, wasn't that grand? Once again.
Isn't that grand?
Yes, thank you all so much for making this possible, and I gotta say, without the Sonic casting crew, this wouldn't be possible either, so I just want to give you another hearty thank you to these guys.
It's amazing. I just walked right into that. That was perfect timing.
Okay, so, I'm sorry. Like I was saying, so Roger, what are the things? I have only one request. Because I'm pretty sure this is just going to be a barrel laugh.
All right.
Ezio, Sonic, Batman, and Belson walk into a cafe, and they're discussing their favorite beverages.
That so again, after we just said. We didn't want the whole like Twitch chat to turn into a voice line request. Your first request is a voice line request of all those characters.
I'm making a joke.
Worst improv ever.
Worst improv ever.
Well, another donation.
Oh my goodness.
But I do gotta say, there's a lot of iconic performances you've done. You've done Ezio, you've done Batman. Sonic is the big one. Diamond Head from Ben 10.
Oh yeah, you were also Frank Smith on regular show.
Margaret's dad, Frank from Chopper Sits, yes.
Yep, that's him.
Nice.
So I think for me, the big question I have is how do you memorize those voices? Does it immediately just come to mind as soon as you hear it, or do you have to get like kind of a refresher?
Well, Mike, I mean, are you the same way, Mike, like with even with Sonic or something that you've done for a really long time? I always like to listen to a reference of where I've been at in the past, for one. But usually there's just a certain thing that each character might say that has you kind of going, oh, OK, if I say that particular catchphrase or that kind of thing, it helps you lock in to a character. Do you have that for Eggman, Mike?
Repetition helps. I mean, after 20 years. I don't need a refresher now, but if you want to compare, for example, the very original voice, which was very Dean Bristol-like, and way down here, and then a few weeks in, they said, we want to add more peaks and valleys to allow for the comedy, and so now there's a lot more up and down that happens. If you need me to reference the very original, I'd have to listen back. But I remember when the big 2010 recasting happened, and I re-auditioned for my role, which I thought I had. And the first session, we'd been going recording for about half an hour, and Jack asks, does that sound right? Does that sound like the Eggman we know and love? And I didn't say anything, but I thought, I think it does. So no, Eggman is there unless there's a drastic change in the delivery, like for Frontiers. But generally, if they want Eggman, I know what they want. But if for minor characters, yeah, reference is really helpful. And sometimes I'm lazy and not paying attention, and there's drift from the beginning of the session to the middle to the end. And if someone's paying closer attention than I am, they'll say, let's go back and check the original when we started. I don't think that sounds the same now. Oh, you're right. Oops, my bad.
That's definitely interesting. I'm sorry. Go ahead, Nigel. I'm sorry.
So I want to get this comment out of the way to go. Johnny, who donated $5. Howdy. I'm happy to finally get the chance to donate. Thank you, Gray Gorilla, for all the work you put into the event. And thank you, Smith and Pollock, for all the years put into the Sonic series.
Yes, thank you both. And thank you for that kind sentiment, Johnny. That's very nice of you. But as I said,
I'll say you're welcome, but I'll also add, you should really thank the people that keep hiring us, because no matter how much we want to do it, they have to let us in.
Uh-huh. Very yes. True.
And while I appreciate the sentiment, Johnny, because it is really kind, I just want to remind you that I could not have done this alone, because I owe this to my two good friends, Nigel and Stalin, and I definitely owe it to the special talent of these great actors who have just reminded me, after I went through a really rough time during college and thought Sonic was part of my past, it just reminded me it's something that needs to be part of me, so I gotta thank them for making this possible, too.
Yes, thank you very much, Bryson. I have a different kind of question for Roger. So, as we all know, your full name is Roger Craig Smith.
Or is it?
Now, there is a famous NFL player named Roger Craig.
Yep.
Do you so happen to be named after him?
No. I think that would be pretty ambitious of my family to have named me, considering that I'm taller than both my parents, that if they thought that I was going to somehow wind up in the NFL with just, you know, with something like that. But no. But what's very funny is throughout the years, every now and then, like once every 3 or 4 years, somebody gets lazy and they just go to type in like Roger Craig. And I've had like legitimate like sports Twitter outfits like tag Roger Craig using my username.
Oh.
And I'm like, I don't know. Let's just do a real quick, just a quick glance at my profile photo. And if you're thinking that's what Roger Craig looks like now, it's like, it couldn't be farther from the truth. But it's very funny. Yes. Yeah, I'll gladly be mistaken for a Hall of Famer any day, so.
Yes.
Well, hey, Roger, I know what would make you happy is if they gave you a free Vegas Golden Knights jersey with your name on it.
I already got myself my Golden Knights jersey, and I've got it customized with a number 75 for a number of reasons. That used to be Reeves. He was one of my favorite players when he was on the team, and I was born in 1975, and I got Smith on the back. We got Riley Smith playing for the – so it's a whole blend of all these things, but – but yeah, I got my Golden Knights jersey.
Yeah,
last night was rough. I will say, Florida had to pull their goalie just to tie it, and they had to benefit from the chaos that is sudden death overtime in any sort of hockey game in order to squeak their first little win. So I'm anxious to see how we do tomorrow.
Yeah, I unfortunately haven't kept up with hockey in a few years, but you're probably going to hate me for this. My team is the San Jose Sharks.
Man, how about this weather? It's,
Well, there's actually a special reason why San Jose is my hockey team. Back when my dad was around, back in the 90s, his company decided to rent out the Shark Tank for a special event, so they brought in catering, we got to skate on the ice, and they had a surprise band, and guess which band it was?
Crush 40!
That was what Saul would hope for, but you'd think so, but it was actually the Pointer Sisters.
What?
Yeah, so it's just, there are a number of reasons why San Jose is my team. It's a lot of what my dad had to do with and a lot of how I got into sporting, but you know what, as long as you guys are not the LA Kings, I'm fine with that.
think that goes for everybody.
Yes. Well, don't say it to Stalin. He's a Kings fan.
Well, one of my closest buddies is a Kings fan too. In fact, I took him out to go see the Kings take on Vegas in Vegas earlier. What was it? April? Probably went out there in April. Yeah, we crushed him.
Yeah, I'm sure you had an interesting ride in the car back to your hotel or wherever it was.
Yeah, it was kind of funny. About like halfway through the first period, I was looking at him kind of going, sorry. It's going to be a long night for you, dude.
So
you didn't feel sorry. I know you didn't, and that's okay.
Nope.
So for Roger and Mike, well, first off, have you guys actually ever played any of the games you've been in?
I'm not a gamer. Well, not since Trivia Whiz at the arcade in the 80s.
Yeah, when he told us about that 2 years ago where he just memorized the answers and then made his way up on the leaderboard.
The question pool was small enough that I realized at some point, oh wait, I've memorized these answers, and I topped the leaderboard. The closest I came was they were demoing one of the Olympics games at the mall, and I stumbled upon that, and I said to the guy doing the demo, play as Dr. Eggman. I want to see what it looks like. Great, thank you. And my kids play it. So that's enough.
Okay.
I actually like the Olympic series, personally. I know some people are going to get mad when I say it, but I actually do genuinely like that series, frankly.
Well, the Olympic Games is a lot of fun.
It's arcadey, but I'm sort of like Davey Mitchell in the sense that I'm at a point in my life where I don't have time to just sit around and play video games all the time anymore. I need something quick that I can just pick up and play. Unless, of course, it's this, because this is for a special cause.
So Larry had a question in the chat.
Yes, Lars.
Roger, he just wanted to say that you're a great voice actor. You're also a really great photographer. Always love the photos that you post on Facebook. What camera do you use for that?
Thank you for your kind words. I now have finally made the slow and painful transition from DSLR to mirrorless. So I use a Canon R3 primarily to shoot a lot of the photos that I'm taking now.
And look at this, Roger. Your character's fishing.
I love it. It's a red can.
Do you ever fish in Idaho, actually?
Yes.
Fantastic.
Oh, you actually do. This is so fitting, then.
Oh, that's
it
awesome.
It's quite fitting. There's tremendous fishing in Idaho, obviously. Lots of lakes, lots of streams.
You know, I used to fish a lot when I was a Boy Scout, and I actually got a fishing merit badge.
I fished, too, a little bit.
Mike, do a lot of fishing in New York, do you?
Well, I would think that if I was going to be fishing in the Hudson River and I caught something, imagine what kind of bullyak monster fish that's got to be. I'm stealing a bit from Robert Klein, legendary comedian. But no, and we have our lovely vacation home in the Pocono Mountains of Pennsylvania, where there is plenty of fishing and hunting, and none of it for me. And that's probably safer for everyone.
Fair enough.
So, I got a question for Roger. This is just me being funny. Are you living in your own private Idaho?
In some ways, yes, and in others, no.
Okay.
Yeah, so no B-52s for him, I guess.
No B-52s.
Yeah. Actually, Nigel, isn't there a question that you've asked every voice actor and actress?
Yes, before I do, Cryptor the Crusader has a question for Mike. Zoom Infinity is now following the platoon. Oh, we got a party of 19.
Party of 19. Thanks everyone for tuning in for this big event.
Thank you so much.
Yes, that's great.
Hello.
It is very nice. Real Uncle Lunga is now following
the platoon. I'm thrilled they got Topo Gigio some work these days because
Topo Gigio. It's nice, Eddie.
All right.
So Cryptor's question is for Mike and Roger. What was the Sonic project you had the most fun voicing?
All of them.
All of them. Yes.
I'll add an asterisk to that. Sonic Boom, because it was ensemble Carol style. Carol Bappi is now following
the platoon. Oh, we have 62 people watching.
62, man. You guys are all so kind. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Eddie. Sonic Boom, we would record ensemble style, not always in the same place, but usually at the same time, and that's always a treat.
So, Paige Anderson, 2023, has a question for Roger. Big fan, I have a question. Since you played Sonic, have you met any of the other previous voice actors who played Sonic? If you have, what was it like meeting them?
Paige, where were you earlier?
She was getting you that tire that you had to fish out of the lake.
Ah, that's right.
It's Groundhog Day.
Throughout the years, I believe, like every now and then, there might have been like some interactions here and there, but no. Haven't had a chance to meet Devin yet. Although, you know what I should say? I have met and had a really fun little, like, quick little meme photo with Ben Schwartz, and the guy is incredibly talented, and he's one of the most brilliant improv actors alive, and one of the nicest guys, and really has a being one himself, has a great respect for a lot of voice actors, and that was a lot of fun. That was fun to get a chance to finally meet Ben. But now I've not had a chance. I was in a waiting room once with Jaleel, and I didn't want to walk over and kind of go, "Hey, man, you know, like, guess what I'm doing?" You know, it's like, at that point, I'm sure he's like, "Yeah, great. Who are you?" So I didn't bother doing that. And I haven't had a chance I don't think I've had a chance to officially meet Jason or Ryan.
I've met Jason. I recommend it.
You used to work with Jason, didn't you, Mike?
Yeah.
Well, he's worked with all of them.
Yeah.
In a way. But yeah, Jason and I would record separately because it's a dub. But those couple of times that we did things in person, just a treat. And we've done a couple of cons together. So, yeah. Nice guy.
Yeah. Cool. They all seem like great people, just like you guys are. So, it's all very... Roger, did you just catch a seahorse in a pond?
Sonic did. I am sitting in my own private Idaho as a human being.
You know that's so the truth.
Now for my question, and I've asked almost every voice actor except for Ryan.
Nico Sullivan 616 is now following the platoon.
Hey, another follower of the platoon, thank you.
Yes, thank you so much.
He's following the platoon.
Kai Jordan trattino basso Kirika is now following the platoon.
Oh my goodness.
He's following the platoon.
You guys are all way too nice. Thank you for joining us for this special night.
This is really turning into a party. So,
it is a big party with the platoon.
Is that Roger or is that Stalin?
I think it's Roger, to be honest.
I agree.
Yes. So I've asked every other voice actor that's participated in this whole event the same question. So, Roger, and I also asked Mike Pollock this back 2 years ago when we did the original Serving the Selfless, but I'm going to word it in a different way because, like, you probably get requested for several different things with your voice. First off, have you had an intense crying scene? And second, have you had an intense crying scene?
As our characters?
No, well,
just any role.
Any role.
Oh, any role. Oh, yes. Gosh.
After some sessions, I've wanted to cry. That's
yeah, exactly. Yeah, yes. Intentionally or unintentionally?
Yes.
Intentionally. Like the director wanted you to cry.
I know that it's happened throughout my career, but I not very often. Most of the stuff that I'm doing it's rare that it would be something heavily dramatic like that.
Maybe Sonic will cry one day.
It's quite possible.
That all depends, Nigel.
Willem Dafoe once says, "I remember seeing Roger cry in one of his Twitter videos."
Yeah, there you go.
I remember that time Roger decided to do ASMR and do it in all his various character voices. And that was the best ASMR I ever found because it completely deviated from the formula.
Oh, yeah. I got a lot of heat from, like, actual ASMR people, too, on that. They did not appreciate me mocking ASMR.
People, it's comedy. Comedy's always at someone else's expense.
Someone or some entity's expense, and it was pretty tame and pretty... It's like, the joke is in what I'm doing and the fact that it's not relaxing, that it's super loud, that it's overly modulated. It's like, that was the joke. But again, thank you, ASMR community, for taking yourselves so seriously.
Contributing to the death of comedy.
Thank you.
Who's been slowly dying for the last 15 years.
Slowly dying, a whispering, quiet, super hot, sensitive microphone death.
Yes, comedy is now crying.
You know, I just...
your original question.
I just thought of something that was... I guess I might as well do something as a... ask a question that's a little more casual, just because this is something I'm sure everyone in the chat could answer along with our two special guests here. Do either of you cook, Mike and Roger? And if so, what do you like to cook?
I like
Mike,
to
you
make...
cook a lot, don't you?
I like to make reservations.
you sound just like my mom's mother. You sound like my grandmother.
Thank you. No, my wife is a very gifted cook, and I don't want to kill anyone with anything I might prepare. So, boy, Uber Eats and DoorDash love us.
Oh, we got a donation.
Nice!
Yay! It is for $5 from Vashbell.
Thank you,
well
Vashbell.
Done. Thanks, Vashbell.
Yes, thank you. He says, hey, I don't have much, but I wanted to put some money in honor of my grandpa who died of Alzheimer's about 10 years ago. Sorry for your loss.
Very sorry for your loss, and thank you very much for doing it in his honor. That's a very, very noble donation, sir.
I should give a shout-out to my late Aunt Minnie, who was one of the original... she wasn't the original Alzheimer's patient, but back when Alzheimer's was first becoming well-known, she was covered in Time magazine. She got a cover story, actually. My Uncle Jack and Aunt Minnie were on the cover of Time magazine, which for you kids is an old publication that is barely alive. And it was a magazine, which for you kids was a publication on paper. Exactly. It was on paper, and you would flip physical pages. But Aunt Minnie passed quite a while ago, but she was one of the original Alzheimer's patient got published publicity.
Yeah. Well, the reason I was asking about what you guys like to cook is because when I was a kid, one of my biggest aspirations was to be a professional chef. But when I found out how much of my life I'd have to give away to support that, I decided, okay, I don't want to do that as a profession anymore. So that's now just a hobby. So besides Mike making reservations, Roger, do you, for instance, maybe catch some of the fish in the Idaho waterways and cook it?
I am not a big fan of trout as a as an edible fish, but I have cooked up some trout after catching. But for the most part, I keep it pretty simple. I cook almost every single night, but I'm like very basic, baking veggies, baking chicken, baking a piece of salmon, doing stuff like that every now and then. Like in the winter, it seems like when you get more comfort food going on, I'll delve into like some soups and things like that, but I don't go kind of crazy. I'm not making too exotic a meal, to be honest.
Yeah. Well, I'm a crock.
I cook breakfast every morning for myself. I cook dinner for myself every night.
Yeah, I'm much the same way. In fact, I'm a karate student outside my full-time job, so because of that being even more on my busy schedule, I wish I had time to cook gourmet meals, but I just don't have that kind of time.
Yeah, it's tough. Well, cooking, it's tough. Takes a lot of time. Takes a lot of, you gotta, it's like, get all the ingredients and not have stuff go to waste and all that. It's not the easiest thing.
I mean, it's an art, that's for sure.
We have a few questions in the chat that I want to get to. Question for Roger. What was it like to voice Snorpy and Bugsnacks? Is doing voice work for... Oh, we
donation!
Got a donation! Donation! Oh, we got a $100 donation from Devin!
From who?
Devin.
Devin?
Yeah, just Devin.
Spelled with an E?
Spelled with two E's.
Devine.
Devin, Devine, tomato, tomato.
Yeah.
You know, once again...
That's from Devin Mack. Is it from Devin Mack?
Really?
If that was Devin Christian Mack, how nice of you, dude. Thank you.
Thank you so
Incredible.
Much.
But... You know what, that is epic, and now we're getting to my favorite song in all of Sonic Frontiers.
Anyway, the Snorpy and Bugsnacks question, is doing voice work for an indie video game very different from bigger video game companies?
Not necessarily. I mean, every job is job's a job, you know? It's like, sometimes you're doing very, very minimal stuff for a massive video game. Sometimes you're doing tons and tons of work for a very, by comparison, maybe say smaller title. But it all just depends. And no, I think anytime you're doing something for an indie title and it's brand new, it's exciting because you don't know how it's going to be received. You don't necessarily know how it's going to go over, and so it's usually kind of intriguing from an actor's perspective, because it's kind of like, oh, this isn't one of those things where we get to go, well, in the past this character was portrayed in this way, and this time we're doing it like this or that kind of, you know, it's like you don't have to worry about any of that. But that's also, the same can be said for a brand new IP that's, you know, from like a AAA studio. So it, you know, every production can be a little bit different, and sometimes they can be completely different from the same production company from title to title.
So it's basically a different frame of reference every time, basically.
Yeah.
Except for Sonic, of course.
No. Not necessarily.
Not necessarily.
I mean, honestly, it just depends. It depends on the type of game. It depends on who's in charge. It depends on what they want from you. So it's always. I go into every session just trying to think. All right, don't know what's coming.
I got
depending on how indie it is, if it's a bunch of friends who've gotten together to make their very first video game, and they've never directed someone, there's a lot of patience necessary to get what they want accomplished.
I can see that. We also have a Batman related question from 12345 RTYHGFDSWQ.
My password.
Was a mouthful. That was a mouthful. Hey Roger.
Now everyone's in my banking. Great.
Hey Roger. Hey Roger, how did it feel when you got the role to play Batman? Were you shocked, happy, and nervous?
Yes, yes, and yes. Incredible. Obviously, you know, getting to do anything we would call in the business like a legacy character like that, Captain America, Sonic, Batman, getting to do anything like that it's all of that, because you know that there's been different iterations and different performances and different performers. And so you're always kind of, you're stoked to get the chance and the opportunity, and you're simultaneously petrified of how it could be received or what you're about to get yourself involved in, because you don't know the production, you don't know what their collective end goal is. It might be something that the fans aren't going to enjoy and that kind of thing, but you're happy to be a working actor, and to get to be a part of something that's big and recognizable like that's always... It's always flattering and frightening.
Yeah, I also have... This is my own question. It is also related to Batman. Now, God rest his soul, have you actually met Kevin Conroy?
Oh my gosh, yes. And, multiple times. And one of my favorite stories was getting to be... In 2018, we were doing I think it was for Batman's 80th birthday. There was a panel at WonderCon in Anaheim, and I was backstage as we were getting ready to go out to do this panel with just a bunch of different people from all the different sort of universes that involve, like, you know, DC and Batman. So it was Kevin Conroy, Diedrich Bader, myself, the young man that played Bruce Wayne on Gotham. We had... Jim Lee, there was just a ton of people involved in this, in the franchise that were there. And so we're all backstage and we're getting ready to go out and do this, you know, this panel discussion. And I was like nervous, because I'm just like, man, it's Diedrich and it's Kevin. And I'm like, you know, I don't know. I was like, I'm the novelty here. You know, it's like, I just feel like I'm just lucky and happy to be in the room kind of thing. As we're backstage, Kevin leans down to me and he just goes, "How are you doing, Roger?" I was like, "Good, Kevin, how are you?" And he just looks at me, and I had worn a Batman t-shirt, and he looks at me and he just goes, "You just had to wear the shirt, didn't you?" It was great. No, because he was just icing me before we were about to go on stage, and I loved it. I was chuckling. I was like, oh man, but I'm like, you're Batman. I have to remind people. You know, it's like, I gotta wear the shirt, man. But no, he was a really lovely, gracious man, like incredibly talented, like an absolute Renaissance man. The guy was a gifted carpenter. He was an incredible singer. I mean, it's like he was talented beyond measure. And just anybody who got a chance to work with him. I never got a chance to work with him, but everybody who worked with him was just like, they just said, he was just such a gracious guy with an infectious laugh. And yeah, it's a tremendous loss.
I know that was one of the things that is one of the few things that I regret never doing, is ever to have either get, there's a site called Cameo, and there was something I wanted to get with Kevin Conroy, because That was Batman. That was honestly like the Batman. But again, you doing Batman is absolutely fantastic too. Like, it's, I didn't even know when you were doing Arkham Origins that was you doing the role. It's like, it's really good.
Thank you. It's very nice.
Yeah, I thought Roger's Batman was good too. Even if I only saw like just one scene, because I never played the game.
I gotta say, Roger's Batman, it's sinister in a heroic way. I like it.
And it reminds me a little bit of the I Am the One Who Knocks scene from Breaking Bad.
Oh, yeah.
Where
I
Alfred... Alfred's,
I loved it. I was good at it.
Ah, oh, that's so good. Alfred is basically telling you to not go out and fight crime, and you basically just go Heisenberg on
when the criminal hesitates, when they stop, the, you know, that is fear, that is what I am. I am the reason the criminals breathe easier when the sun rises. That's phenomenal writing, and it's also the crux of that entire story, was about Batman pushing against Alfred and his help, and the whole story is for Batman to understand that it's not, you can't just do it by yourself, you can't do it alone.
That's true.
But in that moment, he's just like, no, tonight will not be my end.
And all that happening on Christmas, like around Christmas.
Yeah. Yeah, you know, what's neat is a lot of people, they, as a holiday tradition, pull out Batman Arkham Origins and they play it as their Christmas game.
I've heard of Christmas movies, not Christmas games.
Batman Returns, too, because Batman Returns is technically a Christmas movie.
Yeah, that's true. So there's two Christmas Batman movies. That's amazing.
The only real thing I've done on Christmas, and I've only did it once on Christmas Eve, was watch Die Hard, but then again, I think a lot of people have done that already.
Yeah.
So I want to say another thing that I want to ask Mike. So something that Cindy brought up in episode one is that you and her were cast as a particular character near the end of the game, no pun intended.
Yes.
Was that something that they approached you for, or was that also okay? So that was something that was approached for.
I showed up before the session, especially since we're working remotely these days. They send scripts in ahead of time, and I was looking through the script, and there was a thing called the end that I was apparently doing. And okay, and then when the session was underway, I realized that it was going to be me and Cindy together. And at least for the early sessions, Cindy had recorded first, and I was tasked with listening back to Cindy and repeating and speaking simultaneously with her to mimic her performance. So we did that for a while, and I realized how challenging that was remotely, let alone if we were there in person. And then for some later recordings, I went first, and then it became Cindy's problem. And then at the last Twitter takeover, when we were takeovering on behalf of Frontiers, the end had a bit of dialogue written into one of the answers. And no one in the room realized it was the two of us. Cindy knew that it was her. And I had to chime in and say, I believe I was the other half of the end. At least that's what I recorded. I don't know how it ended up in the game. But when we answered that question, Cindy and I got to attempt to speak simultaneously. Which was also tricky because Cindy was remote for that visit as well. But I think it turned out okay.
I do gotta say though, this is one of the games. I'm not gonna try and spoil something, but there is a moment. I don't think you'll be here for when that moment shows up, but there were. I don't know. You got me feeling the feels really hard for a particular moment that comes up somewhere near the end.
That's one of the joys of acting. And
I gotta say,
I'm delighted to have had the opportunity to take Dr. Eggman in the direction where he does not normally go. He almost had a similar moment in Sonic X, but nobody cares because it was A, Sonic X, and B, involved Chris Thorndike. But in a moment in Sonic X, he had a little tender moment with Chris, and it was very taking him down to a much quieter level that was very unexpected. And I'm delighted that I got to do that in the game.
Stalin's just trying to avoid the spoiler alert of the fact that Dr. Eggman murders his daughter Sage and Sonic at the end of Frontiers.
Yeah, the franchise is getting
Roger, what is it with you and spoiling stuff?
What? I'm saying that we're avoiding that spoiler alert. Stalin was. Okay. No, doing a good job.
Yeah, he was doing a really good job.
Sure, for most people who aren't aware, that is my name. That is my real name. In the stream, yes, Stalin Robert Usher II. That's my name. I go by Pre-Stalnik, but yeah, no, that is my actual name. So,
were you named after a particularly well-known Stalin? Or
Colleen O'Shaughnessy asked the same question too, and I can go ahead and repeat the story because I have no issue doing that. Me and my dad share the same birthday, and so we both have the same name. My dad got his name from my grandpa, who, just a little background, both my parents are from Belize, and so my grandparents are also from Belize as well. And my grandpa was a bad kid in elementary school, and one of his nicknames was Stalin. He liked that name so much, he named one of his sons that, and since I was born on the same day, it became fate. And honestly, I could have it no other way. I love every time I go into a job interview, I have to let them know it's like the Russian dictator. That's how you pronounce it. No relation. And it's always just a good topic. I think even when it comes to dating too, people will just ask, is that really your real name? Or are you just joshing with us? It's like, no, that's my real name. Don't get it mixed up. That's my real name.
My son Adolf has a similar backstory. Yeah. He got to
it's not true.
No.
Uh-oh.
No, Mike.
Uh-oh. No, Mike, we don't need to go down that rabbit hole.
I'm just
like really regretting having named my goldfish Trump. Who'd have thought?
I never would have seen it coming. My son was named after the meat tenderizers. So it's really,
actually, no.
Really coincidental.
Wait. Naming your goldfish Trump is actually fitting because the goldfish is orange.
Orange. Yeah, true.
Waka waka!
And its memory is just as short. But you know, I don't know what that means. I don't know.
Oh, goodness. I'm not about to start going into the Fozzie Bear impressions with the fruit puns. I feel
waka,
like
waka!
We did that last Friday, Stalin.
Aren't you kidding? It's been a week already? Waka waka! That's the only one I'm doing.
Yes, Fozzie. Yes.
The Alzheimer's Association of Liberty New.
Oh, hi, Swedish Chef.
Well, that is Stalin trying to not ruin the end of Frontiers when Eggman murders Sonic and Sage. Yay!
Roger, that is an awesome Kermit.
No, it is not.
No, well, it's close.
I will say we're making all these jokes amidst one of the darkest things the Sonic franchise has ever put out. Just the entire destruction of a planet followed by this wonderful scene.
I tell you, this scene is pretty hard to watch.
I gotta say though, again, just all the stops were pulled. This was a genuine moment where I was like, okay, we're getting lore dumps. We're getting the absolute max limit a character's breaking, never stopping. Somewhere in my head, after Sage crying, I was like, okay, this game's trying to break me. And then near the end, it's like, oh no, don't start crying, Eggman. No!
There was a moment from the third stage of the game.
The third island?
The third island. On the third island, the part where Sage realizes Tails' friendship with Sonic is pure, that just broke me.
Broke Nigel and me the first time we played through this game to quote-unquote study it.
Yeah, so Ian Flynn, thank you for making us cry. And Roger and Tails. Well, I mean, Colleen
and Ryan.
And Ryan, yes, thank you for that.
Again, we have Ryan coming on next week, so that's going to be a lot of fun, too. I think I've said this before. It is an absolute pleasure being a part of this stream. Just having to talk with the cast and crew is like, that's the dream right there. And it's so great. It's like, maybe in the future we can collaborate at some point. I just... wishful thinking. I'm sorry.
You're enjoying this, Stalin, aren't you?
I am trying not to geek out so hard right now. It is...
Oh. By the way, but referring to Ryan Bartley.
Yes, Ryan Bartley.
Ryan Bartley, the voice of Sage.
Oh, I just remembered something I've been meaning to ask this whole time. Roger, did you enjoy impersonating Guy Fieri on American Dad?
I don't know that I impersonated him as much as, like, we lampooned a, sort of butchered a version of Guy Fieri, but yeah, you know, it's so funny. He's like he gets like a lot of heat, and I get it because he's, you know, he's still wearing Ed Hardy t-shirts and stuff, and he wears his sunglasses the way he does and that kind of thing. But like, I've heard from so many people that are like, no, that guy's a legit like philanthropist. He works real hard to kind of give back as much as he can. He tries to support like younger people that are trying to do what he's done. It's like it's like a kind of a mixed bag of emotions whenever we get hired to do like a celebrity thing where you're kind of like lampooning something. I did work on Netflix series as Keanu Reeves, and I was like, Keanu's like a really nice guy. It's like,
oh
yeah,
you know what, I think it's awesome though that you voiced Keanu Reeves, to be honest.
It was like, fun
inside job on Netflix.
Like, inside job.
Yes, you would be, and also, once again, I would hire you to voice Keanu Reeves.
It was fun. I mean, it was a lot of fun. But it is kind of funny whenever you're doing stuff like that. You're kind of like, oh, I'm not trying to, you know, as long as we're being cool about it, it's like, it's fun. And Guy was just like, you know, that was just a fun, it's not even an impression of Guy Fieri. It's like, close enough, you know?
Yeah. That's sort of the thing with impressions, too. Like, it's your own personal take on it.
Yeah, I am not an impressionist. I don't do impersonations. I don't do impressions. It's like, I always just joke and say it's a crappy version of something you may have heard.
Now,
like Jesse Ventura from, you know, is Margaret's dad.
Oh, yeah. But yeah, I did this voice last week. and I do it really well. So, I mean, it is an impression, yes, so I'll just say, as Joe Pesci, hey, yo, in the chat, go donate some money, will ya?
It's like he's in the stream.
Yeah. Hey,
and
go ahead and put in them donations.
It does feel like Joe Pesci's in the stream. It's funny, because I just saw Goodfellas for the first time this past Sunday.
Oh, boy.
Gosh, you saw Goodfellas?
Yeah, one of my
Mickey and Matt.
Not that goofy. Get out of here.
Oh, I just want to be in the stream.
In all seriousness, Goodfellas is one of my favorite movies of all time, and I'm a little bit biased on this because I am fourth generation Italian American. So I it's like, I get it. I get the stereotypes. However, as a movie itself, it is amazing.
Hey, I'm Dutch and I like it. No bad blood between us Dutchmen and you Italians.
Right.
Okay, we have a question from Paige Anderson.
Yes.
So I haven't watched Cartoon Network in a while, but recently I was watching TV while babysitting my cousin, And notice the voice that announces what's playing next sounds a lot like Roger Craig Smith.
What?
Is that you, or is that someone else doing that? Because I did notice you are on Cartoon Network doing the announcer stuff now.
Coming up next, it's an all-new Craig of the Creek.
I believe it's actually Keanu Reeves doing his famous Roger Craig Smith impression.
Coming.
Yeah, that is. There it is.
It is an all-new Craig of the Creek.
Yes. Awesome.
You're breathtaking.
You know, I don't know why, but for some reason, I now want to hear Roger advertise a Sonic proc like Chaos Cola.
Ask your Dr. Egghead if Chaos Cola is right for you.
It's fizzy.
Luke O'Sullivan 616 wants to know from Roger, does anyone know the origin of Roger's Hey Terra videos?
Yeah, I know it.
Tara Strong knows it. H. Michael Cromer knows it. I'm sure all those guys know it.
Yeah, we were working on Unikitty, and I just walked in one day, and I would always try to bug Tara, just like a little brother or a big brother, or just, you know, a sibling would annoy another sibling. And one day it was like the engineer was setting up the mics in front of her, and I was just harassing her and had my phone out. And I was, because she was just sitting there kind of like, you know, putting on a little lipstick or something. And I was like, hey, Tara, do you like working with me? Hey, Tara, just like, you know, just annoying her. And she was just goofing around right back. And then I showed her the video and she laughed and she's like, you should totally post that. I posted it. And then she retweeted it or did something. And she's like, I got like a lot of comments that they thought that was funny. We should do another one. And then so the next week when we showed up to Unikitty, she was like, let's do another one. I was like, all right. And then it just became something that we would do just before starting or like while we're out in the waiting room or that kind of thing, like waiting to go in to record for Unikitty. We would just do these Hey Terra things. And, you know, now I get to see her at conventions and every now and then we'll do like another version of it. But yeah, it just became a thing. Like almost everything and anything I do on social media, I might do it like a one-off here and there, and then it's like, okay, it's done. But, you know, maybe a revisit it here and there. I used to do like voice acting tip of the day and stuff, and it was all just silly little goofy things, but
we know, Roger.
It was just voice actors goofing around.
That leads me to my next question. Provide Nigel and I run into you at TMG 2 weeks from now, are we allowed to go Hey Roger at you?
You can, but I probably will not know what it is.
Donation!
I'll let you finish that thought in a moment.
Oh, we got a $20 donation from Kwame.
Hey, Kwame, once again, nice to hear you.
$20!
And he says, keeping the donation streak going, happy to donate to a good cause.
Nice. Well done, Kwame.
Yeah, Kwame's actually a good friend of mine from my job. He and I are really close friends.
Nice job!
Your generosity is most accepted.
Yes, thank you. And what were you going to say, Roger, about the whole Hey Roger proposition?
Oh, it just might be at a convention with it being anybody other than Tara Strong, I might be, like, just a little worried, so, you know.
Yeah, well, my suggestion to Nigel,
If I just start swinging wildly at you, you brought it on yourselves.
Yeah, fair enough, and my prompt to Nigel, he suggested, Roger's going to be like, no, now I see what Tara goes through when I do this to her.
We got a few more questions from the chat. Question for Roger and Mike. Well, actually, they probably don't know. Do you guys know any of the songs from the Sonic franchise?
Only in passing.
Oh gosh.
I've been subjected to the Eggman theme, because of obvious reasons, but. Mm-hmm. The music isn't there when we're recording. It's us in a script and a bunch of people yelling at us. There is no music. There are no sound effects. All that happens after.
Mm-hmm.
I got.
There's your Green Hill Zone remix by Roger Craig Smith himself.
Green Hill Zone.
Roger Craig Smith, everybody!
There you go.
Encore!
Thank you. Yes, thank you.
Now, I noticed some of you in the chat room are asking questions about the Sonic movie with Jim Carrey. We are not going to answer those, unfortunately, because, well...
There's a movie?
What movie?
Because actually, reasons.
There's two movies.
There's two?
Yes, there is two.
When did this happen?
Every day's a school day.
Every day's a school day.
Yeah, so, but in all seriousness, these two gentlemen that have agreed to do this with us are so sick and tired of the movie questions, because first off, neither of them were in the movie. And second, it's like, why would you even ask? They're not even involved.
And the follow-up question is, we didn't have to go see the movie to know we weren't in the movie.
Oh, we got a donation.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Oh, and it's a $40 donation from Whip of Alchemy.
Hey, Whip of Alchemy. Alchemy. Thank you. Thank you, Whip of Alchemy.
He says, thank you all for such a lovely stream to come to and laugh and enjoy for a good cause.
Yeah, I gotta say, it's not just been good laughing with these two fine gentlemen and my two good friends, one of them being my bestie. It's also just been a good time having all you guys here because Alzheimer's is a rough disease, and believe it or not, when I pitched the first Serving the Selfless to Mike Pollock in 2021, it was for Gary Sinise Foundation because it was Veterans Day. My dad was in the military. I have a lot of military connections, so I wanted to honor those who currently serve our nation and keep us free. So as a way of saying thank you to Mike, I figured with how much bigger this was going to be, it's going to need to be episodic for one, but I'll let Pollock choose the cause since he was nice enough to join us 2 years back. So I think we definitely owe it to Pollock for choosing this great cause.
Thank you.
Well done, Mike.
Yes.
Sonic complimenting Eggman? Sonic complimenting Eggman?
Despite the fact that you murdered your daughter at the end of this game, you're still a nice guy.
Now, we have a question for Roger from Carol Bapp. Did you know that you've been credited as Bill Lemass in a couple of projects you were part of? If so, can you tell me the story behind this name?
All that stuff, like, I'm credited for doing things on IMDb that I was never involved with, so I don't know how that stuff gets, like, populated.
And, you know,
that's
that leads...
the exact same thing that happened with Colleen last week, because there's somewhere on her IMDb page, it says that she was in The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. And I'm happy she was able to clarify that, no, she wasn't. So, whoever is paying attention, someone let IMDb know that...
Oh, donation!
We got another donation!
Donation! Again?
It's $5 from OGR Modern Sonic. Just want to say, Mike and Roger, you both made my childhood. I was in fourth grade in elementary school when I heard you as Sonic, Roger. Now I am entering my final semester of college this fall.
Congratulations.
Good luck. Dude! Good luck! Get that sheepskin!
Yes. And I also gotta say, from my personal experience as well, Roger, not just as Sonic, I mean, predominantly Sonic, yes, but there's not one role you've done that I didn't like, and just how much you love doing the profession, and the way you just act chill and very genuine on social media, it's a really nice thing to see, and I like your work a whole lot.
I do gotta say, one of the things that I can really appreciate about Sonic Boom was, much like how the performances are in Frontiers, I always feel like there was so much breathing room in Sonic Boom to just do what you want with the performance. It always seemed like it was a fun time with the performances and everything. So,
you guys are showering us with kind words and compliments, and thank you.
Yes,
Mike, I know I don't. It's like I'm not. You know, I'm sure I speak for everyone. I say we had way too much fun on Sonic Boom. There was a lot of freedom, and that was not easy to come by, because you can imagine a company like Sega wants to protect, you know, just this icon of gaming, and in Sonic Boom they were kind of playing around with the universe a lot, and I mean it's credit to Sega for also engaging in that sort of play and creating a little bit of a universe that they could kind of be a little silly and goofy, and you know, the idea that Eggman blows up his lair and needs a place to crash, stuff like that. You know, it's we had so much fun.
It's yeah. basically a sitcom.
Yeah, definitely.
I mentioned the hippo.
Tomatopotamus.
Tomatopotamus, there you go.
Well, Bill Freiberger, who was executive on that and the head writer, he basically, I mean, his background was sitcom work and a lot of animated kind of stuff like Simpsons and things like that. So, ooh. Yeah, it definitely, you know, that's why that kind of has that vibe. And it's, I don't know, I think for Mike and I, having grown up in an era where that sort of entertainment was pretty prevalent, getting to understand some of those nods to sort of like 60s, 70s, 80s television tropes was a lot of fun.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
It's nice to get references and make sure that references are provided for us to get. So it was a lot of behind the scenes fun that unfortunately didn't make the final cut. But even so, there was never a dull moment recording for Boom.
Yes, which
Bill Freiberger was also the voice of Comedy Chimp.
Mm-hmm.
And also Roger was Dave the intern, and Mike was my favorite character who wasn't one of the main ones, the fastidious beaver.
Actually, yes, I was.
Hey, Beaver, what have you been thinking about this year's fundraiser?
Well, I think that the fundraiser should be sorted alphabetically.
I wonder how Dave feels about this.
Stop harassing me! I'm very delicate!
We aren't harassing you. We were just asking about the broadcast, you intern.
Stop telling me what to do! You're not my mom's boyfriend.
Dave the intern,
well, for one, would like to hear a word from Matt Fink.
Dave the intern.
Well, you know.
You know about Twitch, right?
Ask Matt Fink.
Yeah, I'm a big fan of Twitch. I'm quite the gamer.
I never would have guessed, Mayor Fink.
Wait, you were Mayor Fink?
Yes, I was.
Oh, wow, okay. Alright, cool.
I'm full of surprises.
Yes.
You know, Sonic, it just led me to another question. Did the court ever accept Gotta Go Fast as a medical condition on that speeding ticket?
No.
Oh, that's a shame.
Oh, you know, if we're going to go way back in the day, I'll never forget Garbage Man from TMNT.
Oh, yeah, that was Mike Pollock as well.
That was he was a very slovenly gentleman. And while it's important to hydrate during a session, I would hydrate before each take so that I would be drooling on myself.
Hello, Phil. Yes, I'm actually very wet while I'm doing live.
Oh, my goodness.
Thank you very much. And
that
I was
the exact question I was going to ask about that too.
A delightful moment during the audition. It was early in the four kids' career, but I walked into the audition, being me, and then approached the microphone, and then
suddenly came out with this.
I was walking out. The one of the production guys said, "Where did that cam come from?" And I said, "Thank you very much."
Oh my
god. So humbly put.
That's what I do.
Yep. OG Modern Sonic has a question for Roger. May I ask, how did you approach Ezio when he was a teenager in Assassin's Creed 2? I noticed he has many quirks similar to Sonic the Hedgehog because he is cocky and snarky.
I mean, that's writing that might be sort of similar. When it comes to approaching a role or a character, I work very closely with the director. I listen to what the producers want. It's rare that you get to go in and make a decision to where you're just like, this is the voice I'm doing, and this is the voice you'll get, and you'll be happy with it, and you'll pay me on time. Very typically, I ask a lot of questions, like, what do we want? And then I start throwing out vocal tones and attempt just sort of making voices and doing things like that. It's never really just up to me. So I guarantee you we're going back to 2008, maybe 2007 working on Assassin's Creed 2. So the teenage version of Ezio would have been just attempting to do a younger voice than where we were at when he was sort of in his 30s, 20s kind of a thing. And then same thing with doing the older voice for when he was much older than that. But no, the approach is asking questions and then seeing, you know, honestly, I mean, like, I'm sure, Mike, it's the same thing. It's you walk in and somebody says, you know, this is what's frustrating for me. I always try to come up with the analogy of, like, you know, if audio production was house painting, the way a lot of this stuff works is somebody just go, hey, paint my house. And then you're like, oh, you know, what color? They go, I don't know, just paint the house. And then you paint the house and they go, why'd you paint it brown? And you're like, you just told me to paint your house. And they're like, yeah, we don't like brown paint. And you're like, okay. And voice acting is very often when it's character creation, it's just kind of like, you want me to try it like this?
You want to try it like this?
You want to try it like that? It's like, that's what we do.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, it helps to have a starting point, but sometimes, okay, show me what you got.
Yeah, we don't like that. Thanks. Next. You're like, okay. Mm-hmm. Thought you were a house painter. Why'd you paint it brown?
My grandfather was a house painter, actually.
Why did you paint it pink?
Why'd you paint it chartreuse?
I made a choice.
Yes. Unfortunately, grandfather's not around to verify this. But yes, I'm going to guess that he never got to choose the color.
I was asked specifically to make it look pink, and I was told it'd be pink. Why did you paint my house burgundy? That's not the pink! That's the red!
What character is that, Stalin?
I don't know.
Is that supposed to be Eggman?
What?
No, that's not Eggman. That's Stalin That's Stalin as Professor Scruffy meets father.
Yes. So, I got a question for Mike.
Oh my goodness.
Yes?
So, on
this
Skype...
This is so dramatic! You guys are talking over this dramatic scene!
I'm sorry!
It's just digitized blood!
They fell, and then they died, and then the planet went kablooey! The end!
Che momo trattino basso RN Jesus is now following the platoon.
Hey, another platoon follower. Thanks for joining the platoon, as a matter of fact.
Yes, thank you so much.
We've had a platoon full of laughter tonight.
Anyway, earlier in the week on Skype, I put on an infamous photo. What did you think about that?
Wait, I have to scroll back. Where is that?
It's a few posts up.
Hang on.
Oh, poor Sonic.
I tell you, this scene's gut-wrenching.
Echelon trattino basso 10 is now following the platoon.
That's great. I have to scroll up.
Ask your doctor if cyber corruption is right for you.
No, it's not! It's not!
I see you have the picture of the octopus cup holder with the pens and the pencils in it. That's what your doctor would consider off-label use. That's not what it's for.
Yep.
How dare you?
This is the darkest cutscene in the game.
Dr. Eggman, what can I do with all these pens and pencils in my octopus?
Well, for one thing, what nobody realizes in the famous diatribe, I'm actually doing a tribute to the film Mommy Dearest, where Joan Crawford, as portrayed by Faye Dunaway, berates her daughter throughout the entire film. But in that case, for hanging her expensive dresses on wire hangers. No wire hangers! And of course, me yelling is me yelling, as I've pointed out many a time. And so everyone thinks it's Dr. Eggman yelling about the octopus. And it's not. It's a tribute to Mommy Dearest, for those who know.
So
you're so cold, Pollock.
Thank you very much.
Yes.
Friends in hologram form and having a deeper voice.
Also, I gotta bring up too that, like, Eggman's character development in this game, there are times where I don't know how to feel about him, because, like, on the one hand, as Roger put it, he's gonna murder his own daughter, but on the other hand, is Eggman...
Wait, this is the end?
No.
No, this is...
Be.
This isn't the end yet.
Is Eggman...
But the voice?
Oh, yes, that's me and Cindy.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's what I'm saying, the end voice.
Yes.
Oh, this voice?
Yes.
Well, not that voice. The other voice, not that
voice. The voice in the sky.
Yes.
Is this the magical voice? Talking yeah. voice in the sky.
Wow, 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 wow.
But I guess there are times where I don't know how to feel about Eggman's character in this game because he was such a baddie for so long. To see
oh,
him...
here comes the most wholesome moment. Too hard
for us to give up yes. Now. Those visions we
saw. And since I first played this game just after my dad's passing in October, this reminded me a lot of all the immortal memories I have of my dad. Love you, by the way, Dad. I love this cutscene so much, this part right here. Cindy, Dave, Colleen, do your stuff.
Yes, absorb into Sonic and assimilate.
Sonic, we're even after this.
Roger, you're one of us after this, and therefore your corruption, just like that, is gone in less than 5 minutes.
Project Craig Smith is a join the platoon.
Roger Craig Smith is free to roam the world again.
Good night, Eddie.
It's time it's to like... take on.
Again, you gotta hand it to the folks in this one, because you can imagine that thing being like... Thanks, everyone!
Right.
Just wouldn't have worked.
It would have been a lot
more. Hey, dear daughter!
No.
Yeah, exactly.
But yeah, like I said, like...
I won't let you down!
That sounds a little bit like Mouse and Sonic combined.
I won't let you down!
Yeah, don't let Oliver down.
You know, it's just...
Oliver! Hereby induct
you into the Eggman Empire and order you to save us. Exactly, late. The power of...
I won't let you down!
And Moose too. Let's think of a Roger voice. Aren't you in Apex Legends? I never played Apex Legends. I just know you're in there, I think.
I am. I'm the, I voice the character of Mirage.
Mirage.
I knew that.
See,
I knew that because I saw the Game Awards. I knew that.
Oh, yeah.
Promo for the Game Awards.
That was insane. That was live, A live, like, oh God, I don't even know how to call it, like, rendering in real time of motion capture and interacting in real time with Jeff Keighley. It was crazy.
Oh, Jeff Keighley, he's a great presenter.
Really? Okay, I didn't know that part.
Oh. Yeah, that was the biggest struggle we had with that, was we were trying to show people, we're like, this is, I was, like, you know, 1,000 feet away in a studio across the quad from the theater and was doing that live. That was nuts. That was days and days and days and months of preparation and days of rehearsing and like a crew of 20 people with computers. But yeah, that was in real time, done live, one take to the stage.
No pressure.
Yeah, no, it was nuts. Knowing that there was an audience of millions worldwide, that was one of the crazier things I've done in my adult life in my career. It was a lot of
crazy.
Yeah, Mike's making the joke, no pressure, but I was like, oh, please don't mess up.
No, that's crazy, because I thought that was pre-recorded when I saw
it. Not at all.
When I saw that. That was all live.
It was all done live.
That's awesome.
Do it live!
That's wild.
Yes.
That is crazy. That is mad dedication.
I guess to go on a little bit more of a serious note, after all, we are raising money for Alzheimer's and dementia research. I know Mike has relatives that were affected by the disease, but Roger, have you also?
Oh my gosh, yes. Sorry, I thought you were saying, have you also, and then I was waiting for more. No, of course, this is something that affects, I can't even imagine a family that doesn't have a family member somewhere in their lineage, if not immediately, that's been affected by this. It's one of the most, I mean, my gosh, if not to get too philosophical, as I'm about to, to have to depart the stream, but, wherever you stand on what this existence is, the one thing we can all agree upon is the idea of having the memory of the people that have impacted you and that you've impacted in this existence, as far as we know, can be everything. And to think of something that robs us of that and leaves behind a shell is just, it's just such a cruel, cruel disease. And a cruel thing to have happen. I don't know if it's officially diagnosed as a disease or not, but
Pretty sure it is, because
yeah, I don't know if it falls under that definition, but just being afflicted with it is just, I can't imagine anything more terrible. And it's so bad because it's just such a brutal thing for the folks that are still here to have to sit and witness. And it's scary to think, you know, what it's like for the individual that's going through it. And no, it's awful. It's an awful thing. I my grandmother had a version of it that was not diagnosed as what we know now, but it was definitely a form of dementia that was rooted in that. And it's the same thing. That was just watching a shell of a human being who no longer was and was deeply confused and didn't know who anybody was. And it was brutal. So it's a terrible, terrible way to end the sort of accumulation, the collection of one's memories built upon a life. And then as far as we know, they just go away. It's terrible.
Yes, yeah. Very much so. It really is. I found out from my mother that one of my great-great-grandmothers and one of my distant aunts or uncles, I think, actually, because I didn't even notice, they died from Alzheimer's either when I was really young or before I was born. So, yeah, I've had family members who unfortunately fell to this as well.
Yeah.
It's a tough thing to deal with, but that's the whole reason all of us have been part of this series for 4 episodes now, 5 as of next Friday when we have the finale, because we want to put an end to this dastardly disease.
Yeah.
Hopefully someday we will.
Also, yep. Again, serious gratitude and thanks for everyone who's donated so far.
Yes.
We are
yes.
$1,178.23, and that is monumental.
That is amazing.
Honestly, like I said, a dollar, if you can donate a dollar goes such a long way.
Real quick.
It's like much appreciation.
Even if it's only a penny, it goes a long way.
Yes. Real quick, Bryson Robinson won. He's got to go, but he's made a request for Roger. Can Sonic and Pink Guy and Dr. Eggman and Greg and Batman have an argument about who ate the last donut?
Jimmy sighed just then. I was just sighing.
Who all?
Sonic, Pink yeah. Guy, Dr. Eggman, Greg, and Batman.
Greg? Who's Greg?
Greg from Ratatouille. Have you not seen Ratatouille? You should.
Oh, Ratatouille, that Video Brigado movie that Mike Pollock was on.
Roger, consider this a personal invitation to look it up on YouTube.
Oh, God, no. Please, no.
No, please. I insist.
It's Brazil's Video finest. It's Brazil's absolute finest.
From the same people who made the Little Panda Fighter.
And the same people who made the Little Cars series, Video Brinkado, a now defunct Brazil.
See you later, Peppermint Bubble Gum. Yeah, Peppermint Bubble.
See you later, Peppermint Bubble. It's nice having you and everybody else here, as we said.
See you, Peppermint. Get some sleep.
Yes, it's late in Finland, so go and enjoy your beauty sleep.
Yes.
Ew. Pink Guy got all of his eye goop all over the donut holes.
Which one of them are Pink Eyes? Like, I think this is Pink Eye. It's a condition. I can't do anything about it.
And then Greg would... I don't know, Greg.
Precisely!
That's all.
There it is! No budget media was waiting for Mike to say that all series long. Mm-hmm. Precisely.
I'll be right back, guys. I gotta get some water.
I am unfortunately about to go consume dinner with my mother.
Okay. Yes.
So I say that differently so that it sounds like you're consuming
know,
your mother
sounds,
dinner.
It sounds, yeah, that, it sounds like, yeah. It's like, I'm having an old friend for dinner. Yeah. Yes. With fava beans, yes. Thank you to everybody for setting all this up, for you guys putting it all together, and for everybody who's participated and whatnot, and donated most especially. Thank you, everybody. As Gray would tell you, it makes a huge difference. So thank you, guys.
Yes,
thank you so much for being a part of this as well.
Yes, Roger.
Stalin, Lars, you guys, everybody. Gray.
Nigel.
Yes.
Nigel, sorry.
Yes, thank you.
Thanks so much.
Thank you, guys.
Bell is now following the platoon.
It is now time for me to go eat with my mother.
Oh, just before you go, Roger.
Italian food.
I'm going to have a little bit of a frozen pizza, I'm sure.
Yeah, just real quick before you go, Roger.
Yes.
Nigel and I will see you at Too Many Games in 2 weeks.
I love it. See you. Yep, and hopefully I'll get a chance to catch a little bit of, I mean, like, cons are always just a zoo, but hopefully I can catch a little bit of something with Crush 40 or, yeah, that'd be awesome.
Yeah, we'll see you there, but for now, go enjoy dinner with your mother, and from the bottom of my heart, thank you so much to you and everybody else, sir.
Thank you. Best of luck with the rest of it. You're already over 1,000. Let's keep it going.
Yes, yeah, thank you.
Thanks for joining us. Woo-hoo! It's a
thanks so much.
I have to go eat the Italian food.
So if I just disconnect from this, am I going to throw off anything or?
No.
All right. Cleveland will be blacked out. You'll be fine. Fine.
That's a threat from Eggman if I heard one.
Thank you, guys. Mike, be well. I'll see you at a con soon or hopefully, you know, something else soon. Someday,
sure.
Maybe.
We'll have a rat-tattooing watch party.
Yes.
Okay.
Thanks
Stop
a lot, Roger.
Murdering your daughter at the end of every game.
Of course. Thank you, Roger.
Thanks a lot, Roger and everybody.
See you guys.
See you, Roger.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
I'm going to take the hall pass to go to the potty, and I'll check how late I can be here.
Oh, come so, on, Mikey. Okay.
No, sounds good. I must get permission from official sources and my wife.
Oh, man.
Not up to me. Just like it works. Not up to me. I'm just here.
It's all good.
Thank you, I'll be right back.
It's all good, man.
Yes. Also, Bryson, yes, you can stay for a little longer.
Yeah, we have about an hour to go because I believe Mike told us that he was going to be available until 10 Eastern Daylight Time. So, and also, we just started Ross Island. And as I said in my Instagram, on my Instagram account's post, there was a chance we'd get to start Ross Island. And hey, that chance came.
I'm pretty sure there's going to be a certain pivotal point where we'll go ahead and end the stream.
Yeah.
Again, by all means, I say it once and I'll say it again. Thank you, everyone who has donated so far. Thank you, everyone who has come in to tune in. Thank you, everybody. It's just absolute delight.
See you, Vosh Bell.
Yeah, see ya. But everybody who's been here, even if it was only for 15 seconds every view for this series has been deeply appreciated because we got to raise awareness for this good cause.
Definitely.
We have.
Well, I'm going to take Mike's lead and take a hall pass for water.
I already have water at my side. I've had a bottle of Wellesley Farms water from BJ's this whole stream.
Maybe I should start doing that.
And I am the water. I don't need water.
Huh? Yes, Luke O'Sullivan.
No, Stalin, you don't need the water because you're like Sonic, you'll drown.
Yeah, yes, Luke O'Sullivan. No budget media is so hilarious.
Anyway, Stalin, what is going on with you?
Are you getting...
He's coughing up a lung or something.
Oh, yeah. I'm familiar with that. Anyway, I'll be right back. I said that for the fourth time now.
Oh, man, we just talk the same talking points over and over, don't we? What are you laughing about?
Oh, I'm having a blast.
Yeah, I gotta say, every guest we've had so far has been just grand. I've loved every last one of these people.
Gotta say, again, Detective DDD, no, we're not.
No, we're not bringing in Detective Dee Dee. That's for a Nintendo stream, Jay.
I am sure that a lot of the people joining in don't even know what that is, and that's okay. No one needs to know what that is.
It's something from Stalin's in my college years. There, I said it.
Yeah. I know that there was something Kate Anderson was. Random fact about my friends like to joke around and say if I were placed or. Or added a few letters to my name, I would be Sage Maria Anderson. Pretty sure I don't want to say the real name.
Of what?
No, like literally the real name. You never know.
But real name of what? I missed what you were talking about.
No, the real name of the person. Like the real name of the person.
Oh, okay. I guess you meant me or something.
No. No, that's not that. Because I know that, again, I'm more than willing to share my name, because if someone tries to take that name, and they have,
It is a very easy name to track down. who has my name?
Your dad, that's who.
Yeah, but it's only two people in the world, so it's like, oh.
You never know, Stalin. You never know.
You never know. You know, maybe perhaps there's a third one on the way. I don't have a
Or maybe there is a third one somewhere in this place we call the Earth.
Well, I mean, we can't play the X-Men music.
But really. That was great timing, Cindy. Thank you.
Not ready.
We can play the X-Men music. You are not ready.
No, we weren't ready for that. We weren't ready for that.
You're never ready for Cindy Robinson telling you you're not ready.
What did I just walk into?
Stalin doing his stupid shtick like always.
I was not about to hop into the magical world of fruit puns.
Yeah, you. No, we don't need episode 3's repeat of the fruit puns. No fruit puns.
Oh, no.
Free Stalnik, Stalin. No fruit puns.
Over the rainbow.
That just sounds like Skittles. Wait, over the. Over the rainbow.
Taste the rainbow. That's Taste the Rainbow.
But if it was Over the Rainbow, that sounds like the preposition song from Schoolhouse Rock.
Yeah.
No, actually, the other day, I was,
Busy preposition.
Busy, busy, busy. On the top is where you are.
On the top is where you
Cyberspace
are.
Cyberspace is Sonic's game. If you
over the bridge
into the multi cyberverse, or okay, that was just awful what I said.
Now, I don't know about you guys, but I get the feeling that the animators of Schoolhouse Rock are the same ones as Charlie Brown.
There's potential. I mean, did you know that the Tokens, aka the guys who made The Line Sleeps Tonight, did the song about gravity?
Oh, they did? Oh, yeah. Oh, that's right, they did.
I'm a victim of gravity. Just like that right there. Let's restart the stage. Everything keeps falling down on me.
I know Kevin the Critic is not here to see this, but...
Kevin, where are you, man? Shame on you.
You're missing out on some awesome content here.
And you're missing out on... Well, you did miss out on... A man of 170 regular show voices and no famous blue insect of war that we know of. Because that's one thing I gotta tell everybody.
Mike Pollock is still here.
That's the one thing I. Yeah, good night, Paige. That's one thing I remind everybody. Sonic's not a rodent. He's an insect of war.
He is. Different.
Yeah.
I think
so.
The thing about it though is like, whenever Eggman calls him a rodent. Meant to be an insult.
Yeah, because if he were a rodent, he would have something like a rat or a mouse's tail, but hedgehogs don't have tails. They may have a short, stubby tail like an echidna does, but even so, hedgehogs are not rodents.
Uh-huh.
They're their own breed of mammalia. And now that science lesson is over...
And we're back for at least an hour.
Yeah, we're back for at least an hour.
Technology.
Yeah, Kevin the Critic is a victim of technology. Is that why he missed out on tonight's episode? I'm sorry, technology hates me. They didn't want me to meet Roger Craig Smith and Mike Pollock.
He never said anything of the sort, but good parody nonetheless.
Technology just hates me, said Kevin the Critic.
Kevin the Critic is a busy man.
I know he is, and Kevin's a good friend of ours, but I will always love Homecoming... 4 years ago, where he kept on saying, I'm not going to buy an umbrella, it's too expensive. I go, at halftime at the football game, I go over to the store to buy one at the bookstore, and he comes back and thinking I'm nuts. It starts raining during the fourth quarter, and then he's hustling over to my part of the bleachers to get under my umbrella. That's one bit of shtick I love to keep on playing on him.
Also, something I realized, Willem Dafoe 1 is in this chat, so I don't like. It's gonna be real funny if it was the real Willem Dafoe, but like, if Kevin were here, he would, like, pull Spider-Man, like, well, Green Goblin quotes out his ass.
And there's your PG-13 content for the night.
Exactly. But other than that, I'm doing a pretty good job at keeping my mouth clean.
Well, if it's something professional like this, there's a reason we have to. We're not game grumps here, come on.
No.
No disrespect to game grumps, just saying we can't get away with a lot of stuff they can.
Right. Bryson Robinson asks, who are any of the Sonic voice actors you want to see? It can be from the games or the cartoon.
When you say, cartoons. Run that question by me again, I think I misheard it.
Who are any of the Sonic voice actors you want to see? It can be from the games or the cartoons.
So C, as in C in person?
Yes.
Well, as you know, Nigel and I are going to be... We already spoke to Roger at night. Now we're going to be seeing him in 2 weeks at Too Many Games, so we can... Not necessarily check it off the list yet, but we're going to do it anyway since it's going to happen. But,
we could certainly check off the list of working with him.
Yeah, but if I had to name any other ones I'd like to meet in person, let me think long... Oh yeah, Erica Lindbeck. I would love to meet her because Blaze the Cat, of course, but also Erica Schroeder, the original Blaze the Cat, because not one of Blaze's actresses has been bad, and of course she is my favorite character in the canon, so a little bit of bias, but you get why. I'd also like to meet Michelle Ruff because she was Cream at one point, and she was also Crimson Viper in Street Fighter.
Yeah, Bryson, Sorry, go ahead.
I would absolutely love to meet Mike Pollock in person.
You know what
I'm
saying?
Absolute delight.
Oh! And he's back!
I was about to say, he came back some like 5 minutes ago. I thought maybe he was getting a little disappointed that he was feeling a little left out.
I have been trying to start up a conversation with Mr. Pollock for a minute now.
Well, he was gone for a while, Leighton.
Yes, he was too.
That's the thing.
I came back a few minutes ago. I was trying to...
You don't want to interrupt? You're having a conversation. It's fine. I'll be here.
Yeah, exactly.
I still love how you had to give a hall pass from your wife to use the toilet.
No, I had to get a hall pass to get out of here. I had to ask my wife how long
I don't need
I
a hall
be
pass
here
to get out of here, good sir. It's all in good fun thank here. You.
Oh, yeah.
I didn't want to just disappear.
I would love to meet Cree Summer as well.
Oh, yeah, Cree Summer. I'd love to meet Cree Summer. I just thought about it. Not just because of Roger, but because I love her work, especially as Raven on Teen Titans. Tara Strong.
Yes.
Oh, yeah, I think another, in terms of other Sonic voice actors, I think I'd also like to meet Keith Silverstein, a.k.a. Vector, and I don't know if Matthew Mercer is doing SBO anymore, but Matthew Mercer as well, because I love him as Fei Long in Street Fighter.
Alright, I'm going to attempt this voice, even though I'm a little under the weather. This is my Vector impression.
Vector the Crocodile, here it goes.
Find the computer room!
There it goes. Vector, do you want to encourage people to donate to Alzheimer's Association? Oh wait, I don't know if we should say that in your voice, because... character reasons. I guess you could just say donate to the cause in your Vector voice.
By all means, people.
There
donate
you go
to the cause.
There you go. Thank you, Vector, for making an unofficial guest appearance.
My pleasure.
You know, so there was a question that I was trying to get to earlier in the stream. Someone actually asked a very interesting question. I don't think it ever got answered. So, Mike, I will impose this question to you. What was one of your inspirations for getting into the voice acting business?
Well, I guess being raised on cartoons as a child, but also loving radio and finding the joys of old-time radio, which is now, I guess, really old-time radio, but from in the 40s and 30s, 40s, and early 50s, before TV was a thing, there were radio dramas and radio sitcoms, and it was just... the theater of the mind and people reading scripts and you listening on the other end to just their voices and making pictures in your head. And I found that really cool. And I, at the time, listened to a lot of old-time radio. And I had another wonderful thing that has gone by the wayside, which we've touched on earlier in our pre-call and our previous visits, children's records. A lot of the cartoons of the day would release not even the actual soundtracks, but they'd record specific different versions of stories for records, for vinyl records that moms and dads would buy for their kids, like my mom and dad bought for me. And I listened to those on repeat because they were available. This was the days before even VCRs for most of my childhood. And yeah. I just fell in love with the theater of the mind. So there was radio, there was some radio drama still happening in the States. There's still plenty of drama happening in the BBC, which is why we listen to BBC a lot as well. But I would listen to all that stuff and I would say, I could do that. I could make my voice do interesting stuff. And I was doing live theater as well in school. But one of the joys of voice acting specifically is it's theater without all the trappings. There's no rehearsal for weeks and months. There's no wardrobe. There's no makeup. There's no blocking to remember. You just go in and you have a script and you bring the words to life. And then you go off and bring some other words to life for someone else. So that is spectacular. It's just the raw essence of acting without worrying about anything of that would take away from the process and the pleasure.
Yes, sir.
So
that's
when it came to... Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
That's a very good story to have, but I'll let Stonefish just talk. It sounds like he was trying to build off that.
So in regards to the roles that you've done as Eggman, have they asked for like multiple takes depending on what the material is?
Depends on who's directing, but generally, especially in recent years, I will go with one or two takes of things. Sonic Boom, for example, doing ensemble style, we'd usually go scene by scene. And very often there was only one take of a scene. And if they liked it, that's the take that got used. For games, I'm usually instructed to give two in a row. And if there's not one of those two takes that somebody likes, we'll go for two more or one more. If it's something extremely stressful, like yelling and screaming, we'll go for one in a row. But generally, I'm familiar enough with the character to be able to give the director and crew what they want in two takes.
That's...
I know one of the questions that... I'm sorry, Greg, go ahead. I'm sorry.
I was just meaning to say, didn't you also tell us back in 2021 when you first appeared that there's a photo out there of you in street clothes, dressed in a toga, doing theater in elementary school?
Yeah, I should find it somewhere and scan it if I haven't already. But yeah, my very first appearance on stage was in a third grade pageant on, I think, Greek history. And yeah, me in a toga and a crown of leaves, doing whatever I was doing. And I fell in love with the stage at that moment.
I remember in sixth grade, speaking of Greek plays and stuff like that, for English class, we had a Greek festival in my sixth grade English class. We were told to bring a Greek delicacy in and also dress up as a particular character from one of the myths we read. And obviously, being someone who loves geography and was into Greek myths at the time, I read into it. I dressed up as Prometheus, so we had to go to the Home Depot and buy some chain links from Home Depot that I could wear around me to embody the fact that I was chained to a stone to have vultures eat out my innards. And the delicacy I brought in for class was ambrosia salad.
Wow.
Ambrosia's good, but I remember exactly what my classmate Mike, and yes, this is another Mike, but I remember what my classmate Mike said about the ambrosia that I brought in. He said, it looks like my throw-up after eating Trix yogurt.
Charming.
Very. Sixth grade humor, am I right?
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
In one of the in one of the musicals I was in, it's called Xanadu, which is it's based off of the Olivia Newton-John movie that was a total flop at the box office. Mm-hmm. But later on, Broadway people basically turned the movie script, turned it into a musical, and just basically made fun of the 80s the entire time, and like, basically made the whole musical a farce. And so, in one of the scenes I was in, I played Zeus.
The king of the gods, huh?
Excellent.
Yep.
Sure.
Yeah. Now, we have a question from Late Lover for Mike.
Hey, Blade Boy, go ahead.
Yeah.
Did you have any particular actors and voice actors that inspired you? That's a good one.
Also, take care out there, Luke O'Sullivan.
But specifically, the cast of Rocky and Bullwinkle, who I had the good fortune to bother in high school by finding their home phone numbers and call them to record a running gag for a college radio show that I was on back when I was in high school, the high school radio program at our local college. And especially as I got older and listened back to Rocky and Bullwinkle, just the scripts and the performances and the humor that I was developing meshed very well. But also in various bits of dialogue, there are things that I pull out either consciously or unconsciously from comedians like Robert Klein, who I have either consciously or unconsciously quoted or at least delivered lines in similar ways in various medium. And one of the vinyl records that I was talking about, if I'm ever asked to whistle a random tune, I will whistle the tune that Jack whistles from the Jack and the Beanstalk vinyl LP, just for my own amusement, because if it was ever a copyrighted tune, which I doubt, it has long since expired. And yeah, just stuff that I remember from childhood that echoes its way back when a line hits me the right way. Mel Blanc, of course, is Bugs Bunny in his various voices. The Flintstones, Alan Reed, the Hanna-Barbera voice talent pool. Just all of them, because I was a young, impressionable child watching cartoons.
That's how I got a lot of my inspiration. I remember one thing my brothers and I would do whenever we watched cartoons as kids, whether it was Looney Tunes or even something newer for its time, like Ed, Edd n Eddy, we would always watch that cartoon and say, which of us is who? And I love... Oh, wow, a hammerhead?
Whoa!
I was just going to mention, I remember when we watched Ed, Edd n Eddy, my brothers would say that my eldest brother was Double D, my middle brother was Ed, and I was Eddie, and nowadays I don't see those comparisons, but, you know, I guess it sort of filled my imagination thinking, how can I make a character based off these characters I love or love to hate? And that's how I just, that's why I like doing voice impressions in my spare time.
Same.
Excellent. I'm also going to give a shout out to New York radio legend Gene Klavan. And it's unfortunate because there are not enough Gene Klavan air checks available online. I think there's one YouTube video. But one of the wonderful things he would do his show live and I believe mostly improvised. He went on tour once and I got to watch him do it in person. But he would just lapse into different voices, have conversations with himself, and do that for 2 or 3 hours a day, every weekday. And that was appointment listening for me as a child.
Speaking of New York, Mike, I understand. The last time we did Serving the Selfless, you claimed that New York City is the best city in the world.
Yes.
For anyone who has never been to New York City, what places can you personally recommend for those tourists?
Well, there are the touristy places, your observation decks at the Empire State Building and the new Liberty Tower thing, whose name I forget because I'm not a tourist, and the new West Side development with a big observation deck. Those are cool to see. The Statue of Liberty is a wonderful thing to see. Ellis Island as well. Wander around Times Square and take in the Disneyland of it all. And but also treat yourself to one of the food destinations like Chinatown or Little Italy.
Yes.
There is wonderful food to be experienced as well in the city.
You know,
don't go to Red Lobster.
Yes.
Yeah. I was going to say, I think I've
do
been
that
to
at home.
I think I've been to Little Italy maybe once. I've never been to Chinatown in New York, which I'm now regretting. But have you ever heard of this pasta restaurant? It's not in Little Italy, but have you heard of this pasta restaurant in Manhattan called Pasta Lovers?
No, I have not.
So to give some backstory, 7 years ago, my alma mater took my class and me over to Manhattan to do a job workshop to get some vocational training and learn how to workshop resumes because, as I've probably told you before, I'm on the autism spectrum and it was something I needed to help improve my ability to, I guess, apply for work and learn how to operate. But one of the places we went for dinner while we were in Manhattan, and we stayed at the now defunct Hotel Pennsylvania, by the way, which was across the street from Madison Square Garden, but we went to a restaurant called Pasta Lovers, and I was sitting next to my college mentor, and when I took that first bite of pasta, I almost sobbed, and I said I would order that again in a heartbeat. So yeah, if you find Pasta Lovers in New York City, go to it. It's good pasta.
Yep, definitely.
Cool. And I'll take a moment to plug, if you're looking for a reason to visit New York City in the middle to end of August, I'll be doing an off-off-Broadway show, a show called Towel Girl, which opens Thursday, August 10th for a three-week run at downtown Steve and Marie Zgoras Theater of the Players Theater on McDougal Street. So if you want to come and see our show, hasn't even started rehearsing yet, so I can't vouch for how wonderful it'll be, but I'll make a heck of an attempt, and I will be playing Jason, who, no spoilers, but it's a fun little part, or fun, not so little part. So if you need a reason to come to New York, come see me do my show.
That's awesome that you're still doing theater.
Yeah, that's really, really cool.
And,
I'm happy for you.
And professionally, for that matter.
Thank you. They reached out, and I was delighted and honored. So it'll be a lot of work, but I'm prepared to put a lot of work into it.
I wish I could find a link for the play specifically. I'm finding something, like finding a Facebook post.
It's pinned to my Twitter profile.
Okay.
Now I'm just splurging on everything in the store.
Check the Twitter, everyone. If you're in New York, go check out that show.
So we got a couple more questions. Well, first, let me see here.
First, enjoy this annoying sound effect because I dumped out my entire bank account of fish tokens.
Yes, exactly.
There was a question that was asked a hot minute ago from Cryptor to Crusader, and I feel like this is something that I've also asked the other voice actors. I forgot to ask Watchers. I was caught up on everything, but Mike, do you have any advice for anyone who wants to become a voice actor? Would
you like to try? Be an actor first. Get community theater experience, get school theater experience, because it's not just about, as we've said, it's not just about doing funny voices, it's about knowing how to act with those voices and make them do things to tug at your heartstrings or make you laugh. So act on stage, learn what it's like to act with and opposite other people, because if you end up in a studio, in a booth all by yourself recording alone, pretending to be responding to other people, you should have experience to know how to do that for real. And then once you have done coaching, I recommend some type of reputable voiceover coaching, and getting a demo made and shopping it around. And then when you get to a booth for your first booking, leave your inhibitions at the door. Don't go in saying, I'm so nervous, I've never done this before, I hope it's good. Go in, be confident, give 110%, be crazy. They can always tell you to tone it down.
One of the things I'll also add to that is Colleen O'Shaughnessy recommended this very amazing site called the Voiceovers Resource Guide. It's a great place to come into contact with certain talent agencies if you're trying to get into the business. Because I know I've been trying to get into it. It's been a wild couple of years. I'm finally ready for it. I was trained in theater too, to a degree. I just have not been in any plays in the longest time. So it's definitely something that I need to work on as well with my demo reel. But at the moment, I'm diving into my animations. I'm doing my animations.
Nice.
I'm getting into the animation industry as best as I can.
How about this? Or however that line goes.
No. It's,
now watch this.
Oh, yeah, that's what it was.
I might as well actually just. I'll share that. I'll share that with you. So you want to see one of the animations that I just finished, because I was not animated in a very long time, and so I'm really proud of this. Thank you, Leighton. Thank you. I know.
What Blight say to you? What Leighton Lover say?
You'd be great for the voice acting business.
Absolutely.
Well, you know, Blight did laugh every last part of his body off when you were doing all those impressions while we were on that road trip 2 years ago.
Plus, I'm just going to say
Yabba
this right now.
Yabba dabba dang it.
I'm just going to say this now. Stalin is the closest person I know that is basically Robin Williams in the sense of, like, him just improvising all these different voices all at once.
Oh my god.
That's a big compliment from me, but that's true.
I really appreciate that.
May God rest his soul.
I know it's one of those things that I could probably try and do right now, but I don't want to steal anyone's thunder away. I really don't.
You mean, well, Robbins?
No, I don't think that's what he meant. But one thing's for certain, we need to make sure that Professor Scruffy Meat has an appearance at the end of this series next week. But Stalin, I officially declared, because this is something we've been talking about outside this project, we need to get Ian Flynn to not only make Professor Scruffy Meat a villain, we need to make his nemesis, or Professor Scruffy Meat's nemesis in the hero world, Ruff Barkwell.
This is gonna be... You're asking for a tall order?
It doesn't have to happen. A man can dream, can't he?
Yeah.
Yeah! Yeah! Living the dream. Sorry.
But going back, because we still have Mr. Pollock here, so it reminds me, there was a... Do you have a favorite sport that you've played in your youth or liked to watch?
Only in my youth was kickball, which is as close as I got to being in this sport, because I was good at it, but that was about the extent of any sport. Other than Trivia Waves at the arcade.
Back to Trivia Waves.
That's as close as I got to a sport.
So, we got a question for Mike from Fish Cereal 38501. Have you ever met any of the Big the Cat voice actors?
Ollie Wyman, lots of times.
Ah,
Ollie Wyman, which iteration was he?
Four Kids. Sonic X, I guess.
Okay. So the one I'm not too familiar with, that makes sense.
Yep.
I know which one that is.
Yep.
Also, there were a couple other productions out there.
And I guess Kyle Ibert, before he was Big the Cat, or during, or I don't remember. But
hey guys, it's Ryu from Streets.
At a con or two.
I'm trying to remember, because I know that there was a lot of a lot of people that worked on Sonic X also, like you said before, they worked on Ultimate Muscle and all these other shows. I noticed that one of the things that you're in that's noted here is you're Don Quixote in One Piece.
Yes, I was.
Was there ever a moment in time where you were approached for the 4Kids dub for One Piece?
I did the promos for One Piece. I don't know, I'm in One Piece with me. But no, I was never in One Piece proper. I think I may have narrated an episode or two or part of an episode, but I did a lot of One Piece promos. But no, I was never a character in the 4Kids version of One Piece.
I don't think I've ever played Sonic Skateboard.
A lot of the narrations and the promos for Foxbox and 4Kids.
Yep. I was the main promo guy for the early years of the Foxbox.
And we got a donation, everybody. And an S rank on top of that.
Oh! Yeah. So, the donation is from... Let's see. Oh, it's... Oh my god, No Budget Media. Thank you so much.
Keep up the good work. Also, the One Piece is real!
$4.20 from No Budget Media.
That's the second time he's donated $4.20. Once again, proving that Jerry thinks he's freaking hilarious. Can't wait to see him in 2 weeks' time where he's still a nutty guy.
Yes, exactly.
Oh, wow, so you were with Oliver and Jungle Emperor Leo.
Yes, I was.
That's interesting. I know, I think we were talking about that. I think we were talking about the Jungle Emperor last time as well. Which was the, everybody says that's... It's, I think it's like the... if I remember correctly, it's like the original version of Kimba the White Lion. Before
And there's some debate about whether it was the inspiration for The Lion King and or The Lion King ripped off Kimba the Lion, White Lion. But yeah, it was prequel, sequel, something to Kimba the White Lion.
And that was
and
the,
that, there was the... Come on.
That was the role that you cried in.
Yeah, there was some crying there. There was not... I seem to recall there was a bigger... more wet crying moment. But yeah, there were definitely some tears shed in for Jungle Emperor Leo. And that was, as I recall, that was a very rushed production. It was like a weekend that they had to do it in. And I insisted on making a marathon performance. And as I recall, by the end of the recording session in the unair-conditioned booth, I was shirtless. With permission, with consent. There was much consent given and received. But yeah, I said, all right, I'm getting hot and sweaty. I'm taking it off. And I did.
It's just it was just incredibly humid in the recording studio.
Yeah. But it added to the pathos that the performance needed.
Oh, there's something else I didn't know. I didn't know that Oliver Wyman did Big in Sonic and Tails R. That's new. That's news to me.
Sonic Mario 2022 asks, do you think Kirk Thornton might have an appearance in future episodes of the of this series?
Well,
to give a full disclosure, we've been planning this for months.
Since July of last year, so it's been almost a year worth of playing for this.
Unfortunately, no, we couldn't get into contact with him.
And unfortunately, next week will be the finale of this series because we're pretty much... We're not at the very end, but we're getting close to the final hurdle of Sonic Frontiers.
Exactly.
But I guess if we can generate enough interest, we can get more special guests in a future series. Because I was sort of thinking, I don't know if this is for sure because I just thought this up to myself today. I don't know if I'd make this an annual series because, believe me, on top of my day job and being a karate student, this stuff takes a lot of work and prep. Even though it's just me being lazy and playing a video game. No, I kid, but because this stuff takes a lot of preparation, I was thinking maybe we could possibly make this biennial, meaning every 2 years. Because, I mean, first serving Selfless happened in 2021.
Uh-huh. Yeah, I'd be all for that.
I also know one of the things that, I don't remember if it was this specifically, but I know that you want to play a main protagonist in... any of the works that you've been in. Has that happened yet?
Yeah. In, hang on, let me look up behind the voice actors. There was a live-action thing we did. The live-action dub. And it was probably the closest I got to being what one would consider the protagonist. I'm looking it up with a quick search. Find in page.
And mom,
keep your patience.
While our good sir Mike Pollock is looking for that information, I'm just gonna let everybody know now that I don't think I'm gonna collect the emeralds on this island. Other than that one blue one I got earlier, I think we're gonna save that for when Ryan joins us next week. Because
whoa, that's a glitch.
Glitch?
Wait, where? What happened?
Well, basically, while Sonic was spinning, you got to see what was underneath those flowers, and it was basically just, it was a glitch that just showed the bare bottom of what was underneath, which is just basically nothing except ocean.
Well, let's not forget that really funny glitch on Ares Island back 2 weeks ago when Dave and Ian were with us. The one where that robot I just defeated took the blue Chaos Emerald and Sonic just phased through the ground.
Mike, that was... by perchance, would that roll have been the Nutcracker?
No, that was a recent arrival, and I was one of the side characters. An important side character, but a side character nonetheless. And I'm looking to see, BTBA might even not even mention it, because it was a live-action dub. So I'm just going to actually reverse course and hit the IMDb 1 second.
Yes, the Internet Movie Database.
Mm-hmm.
It definitely comes in handy for looking at certain things. And, you know, also correcting certain things as we've learned through this entire series.
OG Modern mm-hmm. Sonic, I'm pretty sure we're nearing the end of the stream, at least coming close to it.
Yeah, we have about 15 minutes left in the allotted time we have, and also because I want to make sure that we still save some substantial content for Ms. Ryan Bartley next week.
Yep. To some of you same people, definitely check that out next Friday.
Same time, which is 7 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time.
Sam Egg Time, big finale, Sam Egg Place.
Yes, episode 5 is our big finale.
Yep.
And I'm amazed I got that puzzle in one try.
And how fitting. It's the most recent voice actor to join.
And I gotta say, I'm liking Ryan's work already. She's really good.
Yes.
Very, very good.
Bryson E. Robinson 1 has a request for Mike to give him... to give him a shout out as Dr. Eggman.
Bryson, hi!
Hey, there you go. There's your Dr. Eggman shout out.
Yay! There you go.
Oh, I just remembered. Oh, man. I keep forgetting I wanted to mention this. Is it true, and I think we may have asked this before 2 years ago, but is it true that you were on Caillou?
I was in Caillou's New Adventures, playing Caillou's daddy, as well as most of the male side characters for the first couple of seasons. And someone was kind enough to make a supercut of all of my voices together. And as Roger was alluding to earlier, if you do that, it's not nearly as impressive, because you're not supposed to hear them all back-to-back like that. I didn't try and separate them that much, all of them, because I didn't expect for them ever to appear all back to back, but because someone did, it made it painfully obvious that characters unintentionally sounded the same. So, but yes, I'm not ashamed. I'm quite proud. I was very excited to book Caillou's daddy, because having children of my own, many hours were spent plastered in front of the TV watching Caillou.
And,
I know one of the things that I remember you for back in the day, other than Eggman, was also the narrator for Pokemon.
Yes, that's
like, for
true.
A good couple minute years, you were the narrator
yep,
for Pokemon.
A couple years of that, too. Thank you.
And right, when Mike talks...
I'm in IMDb, and I've got to start at the bottom here.
I do gotta say, though, once again, I have to... I have to congratulate you guys, because I gotta say, stellar performances in this game. Like, the performances in this game from everyone are phenomenal.
Yes, I agree.
Thank you.
Like, man, Gray, I'm just gonna tell you, I may weep tears when we get to a certain scene that involves Eggman, Sage, and Sonic, because, not gonna lie to you, that was the breaking point for me.
Like, Nigel and I already weeped at that too, so you're in good company.
Yeah.
For now, until we get Ms. Bartley next week, I'm just gonna go around farming for resources, just so that way we can save some pivotal content for her.
Yep.
And by the way, I love how atmospheric this is with the rain and everything, and this island kinda looks like... Aras Island kinda looks like a hybrid of... the U.S. Rockies, and maybe somewhere in British Columbia.
I was gonna say that it looks like Seattle. And treasures. You'd be right at
home here, Nux. One of the things that I can appreciate about Frontiers, and it's not at all a jab at the music or anything, but I always, something that I've grown to love over the past few years is the sound design in games, like the ambience in a game. And it's one of those things while I'm working on animations or artwork, it's something that I like to just kind of have in the background, like on YouTube. There's a couple people out there that just have the ambience, no music, just the wind, sound design, go full storm. And something about Frontiers, there's just this, it's a very different tone. Tonally, it's nuanced, subdued. It's very subtle. There's always just something like tranquil about exploring these islands. And I always think that that was the intention they had. And if that was their intention, great job. They did an amazing job.
Well, not going to lie, I...
very talented people.
Yes, they are all very talented. Not going to lie to you, Stalin, as someone who has the full Sonic Frontier soundtrack on his iPod, and hopefully my vinyl record comes in fairly soon, there have been times where I've taken the atmospheric music from the five Starfall Islands and just played it in my car while I've been driving through a quaint part of where I live here in the U.S. Especially Ross Island. Ross Island seems to fit really well in a desert or open field. I'm not desert, a forest or an open field, I'm sorry.
The music definitely helps with my meditation.
That's good. At least the more calmer music.
And I found my protagonist, by the way. In Moon Over Tao, Makaraga, I played Suikyo, which was a live action dub, and I was pretty much the protagonist in that film.
Ah. How long ago was this?
The original release was 1997, and IMDb is not working fast enough for me to see the English release. But I'm going to say it was in the early years, so 2002 or 3 would have been the U.S. release date.
Okay.
Is there any way you can send us the IMDb page for that? Because I'd like to look that up.
Sure.
Because I know that's also... I know that I've definitely been, there are a lot of things I've been trying to catch up on. I know that I need to give a listen to the podcast that you're in, because, well, it wasn't a podcast. Mm-hmm. It was a web series. It was a web radio series.
Yeah. Audio drama in podcast form.
Earth Eclipse.
Nice.
Mm-hmm.
Which, for anyone else wants to check that out, I highly recommend it. Like, from what I've heard, I haven't finished it because I think I started on the first episode. And I admit, I've been slacking, but I gotta say, highly recommend.
I'm only in one of the episodes, but it's worth finding if you can. All right, hang on, I'm gonna copy this.
I believe
this.
It's episode 5, isn't it? Like, episode 5?
I'm in 7, I believe. Episode 7.
Episode 7.
You know, I wish that Wikipedia would have these on the page. Like, I never understand. I never understand why they don't have everything on here. Because if it wasn't for Colleen last week talking about Gudetama, I would not have known that was Roger and Colleen. It's like, that's wild to me.
Wow.
And Gudetama is a, well, Gudetama is well recognized. I will say that much. Gudetama is recognizable enough. Like, it's that lazy, it's the lazy egg with the butt.
Okay.
The lazy egg with the butt. Oh yeah. I remember what was talked about.
Like, it was Gudetama, an excellent adventure. That has Roger as Gudetama and Colleen as Shakibio, the hatch chick. I watched that entire show with my nephew. I just wasn't sure what it was until it kind of clicked to me. It's like, oh, this is what she's talking about. Because it was an egg, a chick, and they were going on these... It's really beautiful. It is a really beautiful, beautiful series. Like, it's just this wonderful combination of live action
Sparky
and CG.
Fluffles is now following the platoon.
Sparky Fluffles, I think that was. Thanks for following.
Yes, thank you very much.
Love that screen name,
thank
by the
you,
way.
Sparky.
Thank you, Sparky. Yep. You know, Stone, I love how we were originally thinking... You were thinking, oh, this would be funny, let's use an Italian accent. That turned out to be a bad idea because the numbers and the underscores were pronounced in the Italian language. Now we're loving it because look at all the content we're getting.
Plus,
I kind of like it,
imitating
though.
And that was a choice that you made? That's fantastic.
Yes.
You see, Mr. Pollock approves. Roger approved. Roger loved it. I mean, that's why he went all Italian when he talked about going to have a eat the Italian food with his mother.
Yep. I think for me, I like the inflection, because you know how sometimes the computerized voices will kind of make things sound a little bland, and sometimes it's like an accent that spices it up. That's what I like about it.
Yeah.
But that to me is a critique of a lot of text-to-speech stuff. But
oh,
again,
text-to-speech. You know. I thought you said Texas speech, and I was thinking, what?
Texas speech?
Texas speech?
That's not how we talk about Texas speech. We don't use AI, Bobby. Why am I sounding like Dale Gribble now?
That's cool. Comes from Big Brother.
This I definitely have to watch. I need to see if I could find this, but I will also go ahead and place this IMDb page in chat if anyone wants to
Please.
Check out.
Yes, Suvu play.
Mm-hmm. Even though we're gonna end the stream
in about 5 minutes.
Yeah, in about 5 minutes, the Tiltify page is still open for anyone else who wants to donate. It'll be on for only one more hour.
Yes, and I know that next week it's set for the same time length as everything else, maybe 1 hour extra. I'm thinking about extending it for maybe an entire week, just in case anybody who wanted to donate but couldn't can have a chance to donate, so we have one full week before we officially declare the fundraiser closed.
I have no qualms with that.
Sounds reasonable.
Yes, I'll need to note to self, log on to Tiltify and adjust next Friday's fundraiser closing time.
It's amazing how much we raised.
Yeah, and I mean, that one $500 donation, I don't think any of us saw that coming.
No, it was from Mike Pollock's purple shirt, of all people.
Spectacular.
So
just to verify, these are not...
Lives on.
Your purple shirt is back from the dead. And being...
It's increased in value tremendously.
Yes.
Yeah,
and... Just to verify, these are not pledges. This is actually... Money has been debited and credited. Correct?
Yes.
I pledge $500 that you'll never see.
Oh, great.
Oh, God, I hope not. These are going directly to Alzheimer's Association.
Yeah, the cool thing about Tiltify, just before I get to Nigel's point, what's good about Tiltify compared to a lot of other fundraisers is when you donate money through a Tiltify link, Tiltify set up so that way there's a cause that's directly linked to the website, so all the money goes straight to the charity and not yourself, which is a good thing.
I have fantastic news. I think I found the DVD for this, but I don't know if this has the English dub in it. But I think I found the DVD for Moon Over Tau.
Good.
Good.
I hope it's still playable and hasn't degraded.
Yeah, this is all the way back from 2001.
Yeah.
Yep, that's about right.
The very first year of the decade, fascinating. Or the century and the millennium.
Yep, and the decade for that matter too.
No, we're in the third decade, Nigel.
No, I'm talking about
the first decade, yeah.
Yes, the first decade.
The first decade of the third millennium. There we go.
Yes.
Man, I'm getting so much stuff screwed up this week, everybody.
Yeah. I feel the same exact way, because, like, my sleep schedule is off, and, like...
I have even better news. It's on YouTube.
Oh,
in its entirety.
Is it?
Yes.
Dubbed? Okay.
Yes, dubbed. I think this is... Well. I may need you to just kind of... quickly skim through it to see if this is the correct dub or not. I'm not 100% sure.
Searching.
Now loading. Nigel liked to say when we were college students.
Yes.
I'm just happy
I have,
if this has been discovered and that someone held on to this so that it's not considered lost media, because it's always exciting.
I have a confession to make.
Yes.
So basically, I am like, I used to be so unfamiliar with Sonic because I played Mario as a kid mainly.
I played both, but I get what you're saying.
And no budget media can vouch for this, but he made me play that Sonic Next Gen game that...
Yeah, the 2006 Sonic, which has nothing to do with the 1991 game, as we know.
The original worst Sonic game.
Until Rise of Lyric came around.
Yes, until Rise... At least in our opinions.
Yeah.
Most others. But that was, for the longest time, that was my only exposure to Sonic. And Kevin the Critic and No Budget Media, they both watched me play it and get me and saw me get so angry with it. So that was an experience. However,
there I am.
I have come to appreciate Sonic and a few of the other games that I've seen. And maybe even a little more love than that once I actually start playing Frontiers.
You know, I could always give you Frontiers as a gift when this series is over, I guess.
Sure, go ahead.
I mean, you and I are already
going... Yeah, going to about 5 minutes, it's me. I am in the dub. Look at that.
Yeah. In about 5 minutes? All right.
Yeah.
Five minutes at Mikey's.
Yes.
I mean, there's much more of me in this, but yeah, that's me. Protagonizing.
Yeah. That's me.
Now, when you combine both of our charity streams into a... Well, I'm mainly talking in terms of if you combined Serving the Selfless OG and this...
Serving the Selfless 2023.
We basically raised over two... We basically raised maybe a little over two... Actually, no, not 2,000, but like... Just shy of $2,000. So,
it's a really soft performance,
right?
I'm sorry. I'm watching the movie. I was just watching the moment.
I'm
it was like it. Mike, it's a very soft performance. Like I'm just, like it.
I'm just.
That's acting.
Yep. So, my question to Mr. Pollock here: how does it feel to be a positive force for change with us?
It's very rewarding. I hope it's more rewarding for Alzheimer's research. But for me, it's personally rewarding having had relatives affected. And who knows what the future holds? It could affect more of us even more directly. So let's hope we can stop that from happening.
Right.
That's the whole reason why we did this. Just like how you were kind enough to lend a hand when I wanted to support the Veterans for Veterans Day 2 years ago. Again, offering you the chance to choose the fundraiser this time was a way of saying thank you, and it turns out that it was a very worthwhile offer, because, I mean, look at how we're doing so far.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Thank
Once again,
you.
Yeah. So
$1,182.
Yes, and as Dave B. Mitchell put it, and I'm just going to paraphrase here, because it's going to be a different phrase on my part, actually. That's not a paraphrase. Dave B. Mitchell stated, like, basically that at the time of his particular stream, we raised about, like, $250-some dollars.
Lifetime.
And now, as he put it, and I'm going to tweak on, that's $1,182.43 that is going to this organization and can bring further research and break less hearts, essentially.
Yes.
Fantastic.
And you know what else we can declare tonight, Nigel? In terms of this fundraiser so far, we still have one more episode to go, but at the end of episode 4, we have made, or that's the wrong word to say, we have raised more than twice how much we raised in the original Serving the Selfless 2 years ago.
Exactly.
Raised 507 that year, which is not bad for a start, but to go more than twice that for Alzheimer's research, this has been worthwhile, and it's been great having every last beating blue heart or whatever color your Sonic character is. Mine's lilac for Blaze the Cat. Whatever color your Sonic heart is, even if it's as red and sinister and eggy like Mr. Eggman here, it's been great being with you all throughout this whole journey to raise that money and hopefully put an end to this horrible disease.
And if I could just say one more thing, if I could just ask Dr. Eggman a question.
Yeah?
Is it the more the merrier? Worthy of a promotion?
Well, since, you know what they say, the more the merrier was something in this particular voice, I'd have to vote for that. The promotion one, not mine.
Woo!
Nice.
Thank you very much.
Fantastic.
If you make it all the way to the end of the film, we'll just skip ahead. There's my name misspelled, as it so often is. Thank you for finding that.
Is it, what, did they spell it A-C-K?
Yes, they did.
Pollock.
Lots of times they do.
Oh, man, that's bad.
But either way, still me.
I'm learning a lot about how the industry misspells names, but I'm assuming that's just a whole different thing, right? Like, that's just, it's honestly just like small mistakes, right?
Yeah. I would like to say the studio has some obligation and we would have some legal recourse, but no. Credits are more of a courtesy. The important thing, I guess, is that your name is spelled right on the check or spelled close enough for the bank to accept it. And that's usually always the case.
Mm-hmm.
So, alas, it is getting late here in the Eastern time zone. I envy Stalin. It's only about 7 o'clock where you are. But
I have a lot of other things I need to do.
Well, that's the good news, is that Mr. Pollock, Nigel, and I can all just go straight to bed after this or do whatever we need to do next. But thank you very much, everybody. We are 4 episodes in now, 1 episode to go. So we've raised quite a lot of money so far, but there's still one more opportunity. And again, I need to go on Tiltify to extend the deadline to next Friday for 1 whole week just before we officially retire the campaign. Tune in next week where we get the newest member of the Sonic crew, Ms. Ryan Bartley, to join us as we close off our expedition of the Starfall Islands here in Sonic Frontiers.
Mm-hmm.
Please. Thank you so much for watching before, today, and in the future.
Yes, and I need to go to bed after I sign off because I have an esports tournament tomorrow, so I better rest up for that. So, see you all.
And an absolute special thank you to our special guest stars, Roger Craig Smith and Mike Pollock. Yay!
Thanks so much.
Yay! Yes. And I know you've already signed off, Roger, but thank you again for being here. And also, just because I meant to tell you earlier, Blaze the Cat is the best. Okay, enough about that. Enough about me talking all fanish. Yep. And there goes Stalin's laughter. Okay, now that he's laughing, that's the sign for me to go into Streamlabs OBS and hit the end stream key. So,
yep.
Thank you everybody being here. It's been fantastic. We will see you all very soon. So, see you for episode 5, the finale, next Friday. Same hog place, same hog time. Not a rodent, an insectivore. See you guys then.